This telecast is available on ESPN2 HD, presented by Olivia. We're at Auto Club Raceway in Pomona, California, the final stop of the NHRA Powerade drag racing season. Three championships to be decided, and the tension is so thick. Look at the concentration in Robert Height's eyes. John Force was so nervous this morning, he didn't want to leave the pit area. He'd sign autographs, but that was as far as he'd go. And Ron Capps, he's been runner-up three times. Can he pull it out this time and win the championship? And in Top Fuel, Tony Schumacher still has a chance, but Doug Coletta's in the driver's seat. 22 races in the books, just one to go in the 2006 NHRA season. Championships are still on the line. Nine racers came into Pomona as contenders. Only three will leave as champions.
Bernstein's officially eliminated. That means the race in Top Fuel is down to two. 46 points separate Doug Coletta from his first title and the completion of the greatest comeback in NHRA history. That means Tony Schumacher must go three rounds further or go two past, plus set a national record. A record this team missed yesterday amid controversy.
Championship contenders in the funny car ranks. Today's showdown provides an intriguing scenario as all three are on the same side of the qualifying ladder. But clearly, the man with the dominant hand, the 13-time champion, John Force. If he wins two rounds of eliminations, it's over. He wins a 14. If he doesn't win it, it opens the door for Height and Capps.
Leon Jill Sampei has been eliminated from the championship, so that leaves us with two riders, including her teammate Antron Brown, who finds himself at a 43-point deficit to Andrew Hines. If the Suzuki rider hopes to block the Harley rider's third consecutive title while winning his first, he'll need a lot of luck, in addition to three more round wins than the man he's chasing.
Well, the knots in their stomach are probably larger than they want to admit, but they're there. That was Antron Brown. There's Andrew Hines. Neither one has been clean this week, and they both had mechanical problems. Controversy in the last qualifying session for Tony Schumacher, and the man he is chasing just stunned everybody with a great qualifying effort in the final session last night here at Pomona. Welcome to Auto Club Raceway at Pomona for the 42nd running of the Automobile Club of Southern California Finals, the last stop in the $50 million NHRA Powerade Drag Racing Series. And by the close of business today, three championships will be decided. The first that we're going to focus on, Top Fuel. Doug Coletta now leads Tony Schumacher after qualifying by 46 points. Hello again, everybody. I'm Marty Reed alongside 22-time national event winner Mike Dunn. And yesterday, that final pass down the quarter mile by Doug Coletta just literally grabbed everybody by the throat.
Boy, Mark, you talk about making a statement run in that final session. We're basically concentrating on Tony Schumacher because he had the backup from session number three for a national record. He was also your number one qualifier. Doug Coletta comes in after damaging his chassis in that third session, brings out the car that they ran beginning the season. What happens? Tony Schumacher smokes a tire. Doug Coletta takes that thing down there to a 4.45.2 at 328 miles per hour and takes away that number one qualifying spot, which adds even more pressure on that Army team.
Well, Tony Schumacher Walker knows that he has to go out and set a national record. Let's talk about the weather. Is it going to be there early?
Well, I don't think it's going to be there early. You look at the numbers right now, the main thing right there is that track temperature, 91 degrees. Not real warm, but I still think there's enough sun on there that you can't afford to go for the championship or for the record in the first round. Alan Johnson's got to get that round win and hope that something happens to Doug Coletta before the semifinals, and then the final round where the conditions will be the best, decide if he really needs to make that run to win the championship, and if he does, he will go for it.
Down on the starting line, we get ready to begin the final race of the 2006 season. It'll be J.R. Todd in the right lane, Hillary Will in the left lane, and 8,000 horses come to life with the crowd screaming in the background. Burnouts are complete. Let's take a look at our top fuel ladder presented by Lucas Oil, and there you see our pole sitter, Doug Coletta.
Going against Alan Bradshaw in that first round matchup, and then there's Todd and Hillary Will. Some implications here if Hillary Will can get around J.R. Todd and has to face Doug in the second round.
And what about Tony Schumacher's march? Well, he has to get past David Baca. Remember, Baca has beaten him once this year. Then he would possibly get Hot Rod Fuller or Doug Herbert. It's a tough side of the ladder, and those are the last two pair here in the first round. The seventh and eighth pair to come to the line will be our two contenders for the championship. There's J.R. Todd. You better make money that he's going to get the Rookie of the Year award tomorrow at the awards ceremony. He's got three wins in four finals this year. Done just a spectacular job in 18 races.
Absolutely done an outstanding job. Now, he has lane choice here. He has chosen that right-hand lane. Now, most of the time, the teams have liked that left-hand lane, but this morning, they were working on the starting line in the left-hand lane considerably, trying to get some rubber down because the rubber wasn't bonding to the concrete as well as the right-hand lane. I think that's why Jimmy Walsh probably took it.
Hillary Will trying to stay in the top 10 in her rookie campaign. She is 10th right now. J.R. Todd is 8th. And how about the irony of this? J.R. Todd's been all over Tony Schumacher all year. Right now, Schumacher's hoping Todd wins this round. Good way to start the day. Look at the clocks. 4.53 seconds for J.R. Todd, a 4.55 for Hillary Will. And for the sixth time these two have met, it's the fifth time J.R. has put her on the trailer.
This is exactly what you want to see when the first pair out going right down the racetrack and making great passes on board with Hillary Will. You see J.R. Todd get about 3/100 of a second advantage off the starting line and then just pulled away with his 4.53, defeating Hillary's 4.55.
And back in the staging lanes, he'll be the seventh pair down the track. Doug Coletta on the threshold of a first Top Fuel championship. Would you have liked to have seen one of your teammates, Hillary Will, advance to that second round because you possibly would have faced her?
Yeah, right now with the competition, I think with 57 being a bump, everybody's strong. So we're just going to take round by round, see what happens. But looking forward to maybe getting our first win here at Pomona. It'd be awesome.
Doug, you're usually so unflappable emotionally. What are your nerves like on this day now that you're so close to that title?
Yeah, it's a lot of fun. Obviously, it's first rounds are usually a little tougher because it's obviously the start of the day, but we'll just see what we got, do our normal deal.
It'll be the seventh pair, as we mentioned, and right behind him, the eighth pair will feature Schumacher.
All right, thanks, Gary. As we come back to the starting line, we get ready for Doug Herbert in the left lane, Rod Fuller over in the right lane. Two different stories here. For Rod Fuller, it's been a wonderful season. Remember, last year, he only ran part-time, finished 10th in the points. This year, looks like he will finish in the number 5 spot, and he's won two races. For Doug Herbert, he's going to miss the top 10 for the first time in 7 years. In fact, since his DNQ back at St. Louis, he's won just one round of racing.
But Doug Herbert has brought on Doug Cook to work with Jim Brissett, and this car really has looked good the last couple of races since Doug came on board, and I wouldn't count him out right now. The car looked very consistent in qualifying. You look at Jim Brissett there, but didn't quite run the numbers that we saw out of Hot Rod Fuller. Hot Rod Fuller, we've talked about, you know, for a number of races recently, could be the spoiler in this championship battle. If he gets around Doug, has a potential to, you know, face up with Tony Schumacher in the second round.
problem for Rod Fuller. 4.54 the elapsed time. You saw that Doug Herbert staged deep and then also just struck the hides almost at the hit of the throttle.
Yeah, went in steep to get that starting line advantage. Wasn't concerned about lane choice the next round. He just wanted to try to get the win. As we go on board, watch Herbert. Spins the tires right away. You see him grab the brake, try to slow that wheel speed down, and then he knows, man, he's gone. Dang it.
So for Doug Herbert, his season is over. For Rod Fuller, he gets the winner between Tony Schumacher and David Baca, still to come. And already, engines have fired down on the starting line. Larry Dixon will be in the right lane. Corey McLenathan over in the left lane. The burnout's complete. For Larry Dixon, could this be the last time we see the Miller Lite Dragster? It will be if he doesn't win this round. No news yet on a sponsor for that team next year, but Don Perdomo said Larry will definitely be back. And as far as Corey Mack, of course, he has won once so far this year. Now, if you did not join us on NHRA Today earlier today, there was controversy yesterday in the final qualifying session involving Tony Schumacher.
Well, what happened, there was an oil leak out of the Army car on the right side of the engine. You see a couple of the NHRA people basically waving up there, and then Rick Stewart right there is going to walk over and look at the oil leak, which is what he's supposed to do. He's in charge of that starting line. Now, Alan Johnson, who's right at the engine with the red hat, he's looking over the engine. He's also going to look over to the right side and see if he can see the oil. Now, he walks back around and watch Rick right there. He's going to give the cutoff sign to kill the engine, but Alan doesn't see it. Tony Schumacher, he basically only listened to Alan Johnson when it comes to that. And here they go. They pass right here. I don't know why Rick Stewart didn't tell Alan to shut the thing off at that point. They basically went up there and made the run with oil underneath the tires and smoked them as a result right at the hit of the throttle.
And we were told earlier today a decision would not be made until next week. We have learned he has been fined $20,000 for failing to follow the orders of Rick Stewart. A pretty hefty fine. The end result. Now let's go back to this matchup. Larry Dixon in the right lane, Corey McLenathan in the left. The Miller crew is going to be around for one more round at least. Dixon goes 4.53 seconds at 3:23. Corey Mack goes a 4:54. So as they coast on out, there is Tony Schumacher getting a little extra oxygen. We'll talk to him when we come back to Auto Club Raceway at Pomona.
Today's Speed World presentation of the Automobile Club of Southern California NHRA Nationals brought to you by Powerade. Sport is what you make it. Auto Club, we're always with you. And Famous Bowls from KFC. Dig into great layers of flavor with KFC Famous Bowls.
The Auto Club Raceway, where the next pair scheduled to be Dave Grubnick and Morgan Lucas. Meanwhile, back in the staging lanes, I'm with the man trying to complete the largest comeback in NHRA history, where controversy is not a word that is in Tony Schumacher's dictionary this morning. Machine is. Define what that means in this scenario.
Well, I don't think there's any question about it. We're going to have a chance to watch Coletta right in front of us. We're going to know the outcome before we have a chance to accomplish our mission. But our goal has always been to go out, try to set a world record, win this race, you know, and we have conditions that are very, very close to being able to do that. We can win the race. You know, we got a great race team, and so do they. And the fans are getting what they paid for this year.
Good luck to you.
Thank you.
As far as what caused that oil leak on this car yesterday, I'm getting word it was an O-ring on a spark plug that failed.
All right, thanks, Dave, for the update. Morgan Lucas in the left lane, David Grubnick in the right lane. Morgan Lucas has to win this round if he wants to get back into the top 10. Remember, Hillary Will has already been eliminated.
And that's a big deal for these teams, for your sponsors and the crew to be up on that stage in that top 10, so he definitely wants this right now. David Grubnick made a great pass last night, that 4:48. I talked to crew chief John Oberhofer. I know he spun the tires in two of the other sessions. I asked him why. He said, we were just over center. Connie just got after. So he feels pretty confident about his chances today, though.
Well, you You saw the puff of smoke at the finish line, but the wind light still goes on for Morgan Lucas. 4.68 the elapsed time. You saw Grubnik in his 300th round of professional competition go up in smoke, and that is Morgan's mother, Charlotte, and she looks a little upset.
A little bit of a surprise to see David Grubnik go up in smoke. That right lane was a lane of choice. He was in it, and we saw a lot of cars go down the racetrack. But let's go on board here. You're going to see right after he hits the throttle, it goes up into smoke. Tries to get after it a couple times, but at that point, he realizes he's not going to be able to chase down Morgan Lucas, so he gives up the ghost. On board with Morgan. You could hear the engine go flat just at the end of that run, and obviously a lot of engine damage, which he's been having recently, and obviously this run was no different.
Well, the good news for Morgan is, not only with that round win does he go past Hillary Will, but Corey McLenathan is already out, so he jumps to ninth in the points. Corey will finish 10th. Hillary will not be on the stage come the awards ceremony tomorrow. All right, let's talk a little Monday Night Football. ESPN brings you an NFC South showdown. Cadillac Williams leads the Tampa Bay Buccaneers against Steve Smith, former Buck Keyshawn Johnson, and the Carolina Panthers. Is it Monday yet? Monday Night Football on ESPN at 8:30 Eastern. It's also available in high definition on ESPN HD and Spanish on ESPN Deportes. Call your cable operator or satellite provider today. All right, back at the starting line, it's time for Steve Torrance in the left lane, Melanie Troxell in the right lane. We have been informed by NHRA officials Morgan Lucas was charged with oil. That means it costs him 15 points and cash. What's more important about that, 15-point penalty means he's back in 11th place in the points. He's going to have to win the next round. It's back to Corey Mack in ninth. Hillary Will 10th, Morgan Lucas 11th, and that is Morgan's tire at the end of the run. So obviously some blistering that we're seeing on the track. Let's get ready for the lady right there who really set the sport on fire at the beginning of the year, going to 6 final rounds in the first 7 races.
And one of the reasons we could see the biggest comeback of all time was because she was so dominant in the first half of the season and then pretty much fell off the map after that. Crew Chief Richard Hogan admittedly just said he did not have a handle on the hot racetracks. These are the kind of conditions he likes, where it's a little bit cooler, track's a little bit tighter. And oh man, it looks like we're losing a belt and it's getting into the...
And that's in Steve Torrance's car. They're gonna send him.
Might as well. Got nothing to lose. As long as it's running.
Well, he makes it down the quarter mile, but it's Melanie that takes the win light. 4.55 seconds, the elapsed time for Melanie. A 4.62 for Steve Torrance. So as Melanie turns the corner at the far end of the racetrack here at Auto Club Raceway. Of course, we still have the big battles coming up between our 2 points contenders. They'll be the 7th and 8th pair in Top Fuel. Tony Schumacher, can he track down and catch Doug Coletta, or does Coletta get his first Top Fuel title?
But not only just to win a third in a row, to beat the caliber of teams that we're competing with right now, I think that would be one of those trophies like I always talk about that sit on that shelf, really shine.
And that question is yet to be answered here at Auto Club Raceway at the 42nd edition of the Automobile Club of Southern California. Here we get ready with Brandon Bernstein, who was eliminated from the championship chase after qualifying yesterday, with Mike Strasburg. First, let's check in with Dave Reif.
And Marty, on any given Sunday, John Force can be found aboard a scooter, bebopping from the front to the back, going to the left to the right, and that's your way of staying calm. But this ain't a normal Sunday.
No, it's a tough Sunday. You got to get this thing out, and you don't want to get mental. I'm sure Caps and Robert Height are feeling the pressure. But we've got a job to do today, and I want to focus on winning. That's what's critical. Winning this race, one of my cars and a Mustang need to win it. But don't think I ain't got the gut ache. But I'm going around just being John Force, because it's a beautiful day. I'm lucky to have this job, and I'm proud to be here to represent my sponsors, and the fans are happy, and at the end of the day, we'll see what happens.
Believe me, behind those sunglasses, there is not a wishy-washy John Force. He wants another one of those.
It would be number 14. Here we go. Strasburg goes up in smoke, and you see a nice 4:50 elapsed time by Bernstein. Remember, he ran 4:47 in qualifying. That was his quickest run of the season. He backs it up here with a first round 4:50 elapsed time, and that is low for this first round, Mike.
Tim Richardson's going to that new style injector you see at the top of the engine this race. He's said he's basically in test mode for next year. Well, he's got to be loving the test session right there. That's the injector there. Different style. He says now he obviously likes what he sees, but it definitely changes the way his tune-up reacts. It wants a little more here, a little less there. But, boy, I've got to imagine he's going to feel pretty good about next year the way this thing's been reacting.
So he's at the far end of the racetrack, and meanwhile back at the starting line, there he is, the points leader, Doug Coletta. Through the water box. Completing the burnout. Over in the left lane, it will be Alan Bradshaw, the number 16 qualifier. He's been on the bump five times prior, and he's upset the number one qualifier three times, so don't count him out. If you're just tuning in, Top Fuel Championship is at stake. This is our first of two key matchups. Doug Coletta leads Tony Schumacher by 46. To win the championship, Doug advances to the final round. It doesn't matter what Schumacher does. That's the easiest scenario. Of course, Doug, after that great pass last night, has a chance at a national elapsed time record if he runs between those numbers that you see on the screen. But I don't think they're going to try that.
And Marty, yesterday we chronicled the chassis change that this team went through yesterday, and I spoke with Ron Tobler a great deal about that chassis. This was the chassis they started the season with, went up to St. Louis with. It's a four-time winning chassis. Virtually all the components that were on that car stayed on that car. That's what made it easy for this team to bring that car off the trailer. Ron said these pipes have a little bit of a personality to them. He said he just flipped back into his notes, found out what this car needed in terms of wheelie height and other things, and that's why they were able to go down the racetrack 445. His approach a little different today, just wants to go to A to B and knows he has a car that can do it.
He has won two championships with his wife, Shirley Muldowney. Can he give Doug Coletta his first? We're about to find out as he takes another step in the quest. No contest, one step closer, and look at the elapsed time. 4.48 seconds, 331 miles an hour. And this team didn't take it easy.
I'll say they didn't take it easy. Ron Tolbert's got to be happy with what he sees there. His driver did the job on the start line, then runs the number.
How about that one, 448? Taking it easy?
Probably a little bit more than I thought it would do, but it's amazing sometimes when you back those things down that they'll surprise you. So it, bottom line is we got the round win. We're going to have a tough matchup next round. It's far from over.
Some honesty out of a crew chief. You've got to love that.
Big hug there from Jim Oberhofer. And there is Don Schumacher. And there is his son, Tony. He has just seen what has been done in front of him. Now it's his turn. He has to answer. He loses this round. The championship is over. And David Baca wants to put him on the trailer permanently for the season. He beat Tony for the first time in his career. Back at Richmond, that was in round one when Tony was the number one qualifier. Here are the current points. With Doug's round win, it is up to 66. And as we said, if Tony wants to win the championship, he needs to advance three rounds further than Coletta or go two more rounds and set a national elapsed time record.
So the key here right now is just to get this round win. I can't believe they would go for the national record at this point. You know, Alan Johnson wants to get this win. That doesn't mean they can't go out there and run a 446 or 447 because we know the track conditions look pretty good based on what Doug Coletta ran that when he ran that 448 right in front of him.
That's exactly what Alan Johnson just told me when I asked him about the cool conditions right now. It's going to be as cool for the first three rounds at least. Do you think about a record? He says, absolutely not. We need to focus on going rounds, and if that record comes into play later, we'll get after it again then. So Alan Johnson looking for a 450 run, perhaps a high 440, just like we saw out of the Top Fuel point leader in that right lane.
Championship battle continues, and Schumacher answers with a 448 pass at 328 miles an hour. So the contest for who's going to take home the crown goes to the second round as both title contenders advance.
And Alan Johnson walking back to his pit area, you got to be plenty happy with that one.
Yeah, that's fine. You know, I got to be careful. There's no sense in trying to set a record when it's not possible. So, you know, we're just trying to keep going around and see what happens.
As far as what happened for the oil leak last night, any indication what that was?
Just had a leak.
That's pretty succinct. Move on. Let's go. Next subject. There's Tony at the far end of the racetrack. Let's take another look at the run.
Tony Schumacher did a great job there. He was right on the reaction time. That's what I like to see. He was aggressive on the lights. He didn't back off like we saw him in Reading. That might have cost him some round wins there.
And with Tony Schumacher, an aggressive start with the light. You run the 48 with a 6. How big was that for you, particularly when you sat and watched Coletta put a 40 number up there?
Yeah, it's not often I get to be a spectator, man. There's nothing in the world like being the eighth pair and watch Bernstein go out and win around and run good, too. Not just win around lucky, but, you know, do a good job. But for the U.S. Army, that was huge. We're 3 rounds back. We need to be in the finals to set a world record. Everything else is out of our hands, man. We just got to go try to win this race.
All right, thanks.
You bet.
So they'll catch their breath just long enough to get ready for second round action. Let's take a look at our top fuel ladder presented by Lucas Oil. And there is the key matchup, Doug Coletta with J.R. Todd. That could be a real dandy to watch. Don't go anywhere there. And don't count out this one. Rod Fuller and Tony Schumacher in the battle for the championship. And, oh, look at this. The last time we'll see the battle of the beer wagon side by side, second round, Bernstein and Dixon. There is the trophy that goes to the champion of 2006. We're going to head to commercial break. When we come back, it's time for the Funny Car Championship to continue. Will it be Robert Height, Ron Capps, or John Force that takes home the championship? Stay with us and find out. Back here at Automobile Club Raceway at Pomona. We're getting ready for Funny Car action, but first, it's time for this week's edition of Powerade Power Time. In this week's Powerade Power Time, we focus on a love story featuring Funny Car driver Jack Beckman and his wife of almost 1 week, the former Jenna Lucy. Only this isn't your typical love story, but then again, Jack and Jenna are not your typical couple.
I was introduced to her at one of the races through some mutual friends because she was a student. Then later that day, her car comes up broken. Well, her and her mom are both cute gals, don't really know the 916s from the 716s, so there's 37 guys over there helping them work on their race car.
I broke a torque converter, I think it was at the time, and I didn't know what a torque converter was at that time. Now I do. So a whole bunch of guys came over and helped me fix the car, and Jack was one of the guys, and we've been buds ever since.
Jenna and I had a friendship that was... it was best friends. It was like being brothers and sisters. Sometimes I wish it wasn't because I told her everything about my life. I started feeling a little under the weather. I thought maybe I had a flu. I'd feel good for a few weeks, then it would come back again. I was in and out of the doctor a bunch of times. They couldn't find anything wrong. Then my kidneys started hurting, and it really wasn't until May of 2004 that they were able to diagnose it. By the time they diagnosed it was non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, it had spread from my pelvis all the way up to my neck.
It was very difficult to see him not be able to get around very well, not be able to get off the couch very well. He lost a lot of weight, and it was very thin in his face, and it was just hard to see because he didn't look like Jack for a while.
When it was obvious my hair was falling out, I said, listen, let's just shave my head. There's no point in trying to mask this. So we made a ritual of it. She shaved my head. She took me to chemo that day and just treated me like the most special person on the planet.
I wasn't sure what the outcome would be, and it's scary when you're not sure what the future holds. And he was my best friend at the time, and I thought I was going to lose one of the most important people in my life.
It starts sinking in as you're hearing the wedding song and watching your bride comes toward you, but it still hasn't completely sunk in. And I imagine after we get through this race and have a chance to have a real honeymoon, things will start becoming a little bit more real to us.
I enjoy every day. I enjoy all the time I spend with Jack, and I take in all the moments. And I look forward to every day with him, to every moment with him, and that's all you can do.
And another piece of good news, October 25th marked the 2-year anniversary of Jack Beckman being cancer-free. Let's take a look now at our funny car ladder presented by Lucas Oil. And you're saying, wait a minute, the left side, where is the championship contenders? Bingo, there they are. This is going to be good.
And one of those contenders is Robert Hyde, who has already improved to the number two position in points, wants to get that number one spot. Robert, we were just talking, 11 years in the John Force organization. You've got plenty of experience being a crew guy, but as a driver, your first time in this position, what's it like?
Well, it's exciting. You know, I'm glad to be in this position, the last race of the year. But I tell you what, I can't do it any different than how we got here. We've gotten here by doing it a certain way, and that's the only way I know how to do it, and that's what I'm going to try to do today.
Settle up.
Out on the starting line, we're getting ready for Tommy Johnson Jr. in the right lane, and the last time that Gary Selzy will wear the number one for a while, he's in the left lane.
What a difference a year makes. This is a matchup the second round when TJ took out Gary Selzy, and all Gary could do was watch Tony Petrone take out Force and give him the championship last year.
For 2 years in a row, Tommy Johnson Jr. takes out Gary Selzy. Selzy went up in smoke early. Tommy leaned on the motor hard, runs five flat at only 279, but he gets the round win.
Take a look at Gary Selzy. You're going to see him spin the tires probably a couple hundred feet off the starting line. Looks like it, right just past that shake point, he tries to backpedal the car. At that point, TJ was pulling away. He had some good numbers early. Then it looked like it may have possibly started spinning the tires before it started eating itself up. But the end result is still TJ's into the next round.
So a disappointing end to a disappointing season for Gary Selzy. That team will regroup. He's all set for next year. He'll be back with a vengeance. Down on the starting line, we get ready now for Dell Worsham and Gary Densham. But first, let's check in with Dave Reif.
Ron Capps just poked his head underneath John Force's car, gave him a good luck, so to speak. How are you feeling?
I'm good. Frank Manzo just came by, gave me a good word of advice. And, you know, this is, I told, wait for the burnout. Another burnout.
And one more to come, absolutely. That's our next pair of cars. Gary Densham completing the burnout.
Well, I went up to cheer Gary on, and you walk up here, man, you look out, and the stands are packed, and it's ticket sales were out the roof, and walking back saw Forrest, and he gave me the thumbs up, and I told our guys, you know, we had a meeting this morning with Ace, and just enjoy this morning. I mean, let's enjoy it. It's pressure, but gosh darn it, this is fun. I mean, it's, gosh, to be here, battling for a championship, no matter what happens today, it's going to be fun. I'm a lot better than I was last year when you talked to me, Dave, so... Brew guys, I can't thank everybody at home enough, everybody on the internet that cheers us on, win or lose. It's going to be fun.
Good luck to you.
Yeah, last year he was throwing up more than he was doing just about anything else. He was so nervous. All right, let's talk about Dell Worsham. Let's take you back to the second session in qualifying. First session he ran a career number one pass of 471, and then this happened.
Backfires that blower big time, and the body buckles, had a hard time getting to the chute levers. In fact, he couldn't get to them, and then takes her into the sand. He had slowed it down to about 85 miles per hour, the wheel sensor showed before he hit that sand, but man, it didn't seem like it was going that slow because it started barrel rolling.
Yeah, and his dad, Chuck Worsham, was at the starting line. Of course, they work hand in hand on this race team, and there he is as they were watching all the repairs going into getting a backup car ready, and here they are. Can he advance to second round over Gary Densham? Pedal fest. And it's going to go to the wind light to Gary Densham. He gets there first. A 634 to a 636. Let's see, I think we'd have to go back to about 1970s for those last times, right?
Hey, that was a great race, though. I mean, you got to give it to him. Both drivers did a great job to get him to recover. Just Gary Densham got there first.
Well, for Gary, he has gone past first round now five times this year, and it's the first one since Seattle.
Yeah, you see the key there. Dell Worsham smoked the tires first, but then he gets the thing back reeled in, but cylinder's out. Gary Densham was a little bit further ahead, and then his engine quits just before the finish line, and Dell almost drives around him, but not quite. Watch this. This is fun. Right there, Gary's engine goes dead. Obviously, he's probably broke a blower belt or something, and here comes Dell Worsham, the Valvoline winner's camp, about a car length, but boy, he was moving fast at the end. Dell Worsham was.
The bad news for Dell Worsham, with this loss, it'll be the first time since 1997 he will not finish in the top 10 in the championship points. And there he is with that fractured tailbone, gingerly getting out of the car. Now you're looking at Jack Beckman, and boy, has this guy been hot. Coming off that win 2 weeks ago at Las Vegas, he comes out here and takes the pole. right now, he gets ready to go up against Scott Coletta. First, let's talk a little college basketball action on ESPN2. It begins Monday night with regional final from the CBE Classic. That's ESPN2 Monday at 7 Eastern. Then, it continues Monday night with tip-off action from the NIT season tip-off. The Indiana Hoosiers' first game in Kelvin Sampson's era. They take on the Lafayette Leopards. Dick's Sporting Goods NIT season tip-off on ESPN2 Monday at 9 Eastern on ESPN2 and ESPN2 HD. Saw in the Powerade Power Time the story of Jack Beckman. What a turnaround and what a stunning performance he's had since taking over this Matco Tools flopper.
And from Jack Beckman all the way back to when Whit Bazemore left his team, both those guys talk a lot about the Matco Tools guys and the job that they do and how good they are at what they're doing. You got to keep in mind, this is a team that went through all of that too, so there was the emotional roller coaster, the highs, the lows, trying to train Jack, trying to get over the fact that Whit Bazemore left his team. So a tip of the hat to those guys as well. They have done an incredible job amid a little bit of controversy themselves.
That's Todd Okahara right there, closest to you. He's the man that tunes that Matco Tools funny car. Over in the other lane, Scott Coletta did some serious damage to the Toyota body. He's got the backup body on now. Will it have an effect? Well, Jack Beckman goes 4.71 seconds, and that is a backup. So he has got the speed backup that he was looking for. Take a look at that, 332 miles an hour. Remember, he went 333 yesterday. Where are they getting the horsepower? Everybody else is going to be trying to find out because they need it, especially if you're John Force in the championship chase. Don't go away. When we come back, it's Force versus Jim Head as all the heavy hitters are coming this way in Funny Car.
The Buccaneers battle.
Back here at Auto Club Raceway, the engines have fired in Funny Car. That's Austin Coyle trying to give John Force his 14th Funny Car Championship as they both roll through the water box. Jim Head in the left lane, John in the right. Let's listen to the burnouts. Burnouts are complete. Take a look at the current point standings. John leads Robert Height by 72 after qualifying. Ron Capps has fallen to third, 73. But really, it's all irrelevant. They've got to go three rounds further than John.
Yeah, John just basically needs to get to that second round right now. I mean, that's the focus of this team right here. And you got to remember, I mean, he is leading the championship, but they haven't had a dominant race car, and they haven't had the most consistent race car all year long. They've spun the tires at key moments a number of times during the course of the season. Could it happen here? I don't know. The track conditions are pretty good. We have seen a little bit of tire smoke, but the track does look like it's in pretty good shape.
Notice he has four losses in round number one. He's never won the championship when he's had five or more, but he's only lost in the first round here, well, once. That was back in 1992, and there is the family Force.
So the track temps are creeping up a little bit to 94 degrees.
On through 4.80 seconds. Looked like the car nosed over, Mike.
Yeah, something went away just before the finish line, but luckily for him, he was far enough to get the win. The car was running pretty good early. John staged a little bit deep, which takes a little bit of elapsed time off it, but he was running almost 267 miles per hour at the eighth. So that means Austin Coyle, Bernie Federle had a great tune-up on that car and had a charger through the middle before it quit just before the finish line.
Dave?
Walking back to the starting line with Bernie Federle, they've got the magic of the racing electronics radios. Have you guys talked? Obviously, you're talking right now.
Yeah, we are. We had to pass the news.
What did John say? Did it nose over at the end there?
He didn't know for sure if the car quit before the finish line, so he wasn't quite sure what was going on. So we just kind of reassure him.
And coming up right behind him, very same lane, Robert Height.
And we can hear the burnout in the background, and the engine comes to life in the other lane. And while they're getting ready for the starting line, let's go to the far end. Gary?
John, you're now one round win away from a 14th championship. How big was that run, and how successful was it? Because it looked like the car nosed over at the end.
Lost the door belt, I think. Yeah, she just parked. She parked, and I was yelling, where was that? Because they'll come around you. But I want to talk about it being over. Because you know what a Hail Mary is? I threw one in high school. Only touchdown pass I ever threw. Closed my eyes and threw it. Cap can win this race. I could go out next round. He could set the national record. It's a long stretch, but he could. But I know Robert Height could. So right now, I'm just going to focus and not get into nothing in my head, and just tell my sponsors, Powerade, Castrol, Mac Toolfram, Autolite, all these guys, Auto Club, that, and NHRA, for the new bleachers and the booths up there. It's just, I don't want to talk about it until it's over. I'm sorry.
He's gone, and he's worrying.
All right, here's the scenario right now. Both Robert Height and Ron Capps not only have to go out and win this race, John has to lose next round, and both of those guys have to set a national elapsed time record. Tall, tall order.
That's putting it mildly, Marty. But I'll tell you, if one car could do it, this is the car that can. But right now, just like Tony Schumacher we saw on Top Fuel, Jimmy Prok right now just wants to focus on getting this round win. He's not thinking about a national record. Just run as quick as he thinks he can in that lane without spinning the tires, get his driver into the next round.
Left lane, Bob Gilbertson. Here we go. Robert Height is still alive. 4.70 seconds, 324 miles an hour.
Hi, Bernie.
And Jimmy Prok, we always talk to drivers about their nerves and how are they feeling. How do crew chiefs feel before first rounds of championship races?
It's always nerve-wracking, but, you know, we're just out here doing the best we can. I feel pretty good today.
When do you start thinking record and champion?
At the end. It don't matter if Force wins next round, if he loses next round, then we'll worry about it if we get to the final.
And that's probably about the only way you can look at it is, you got to take it one round at a time. They do not control their own destiny as long as John Force is in this race. There's Eric Medlin. Eric, of course, a runner-up here last year at the finals. Tony Schumacher. Phil Burkhart will be over in the left lane. Let's go to the far end, Gary.
And Robert Height, that's called taking care of business. I know it's still a long shot, but tell us about that run, a 70.
That was good. That was the first time we made it down the right lane this weekend. So I was a little nervous when Jimmy said, he said that left lane's not quite as good, so we had to take the right. I tell you what, after Vegas, I'm just happy to get through the burnout. But being here at the Auto Club Raceway and the last day of the season racing for the championship, unbelievable. Lucky guy.
Looking forward to round two.
Thanks.
The reference to Las Vegas was when they broke in the first round right after the burnout. The car is coming back to the starting line after the burnouts here with Eric Medlin in the right lane, Phil Burkhart in the left lane. Let's bring in Antron Brown. He's back in the pits. All right, we talked about not having butterflies, but knots. How big are they in your stomach right now?
Well, the knots have shriveled up a little bit because we're going out here. We're just going to try to do the best we can do out there, Marty. It's nerve-wracking. You're just close to the championship, and we've been hiccuping and qualifying, but we're going to pull it tight. I got great confidence in my crew chief, Steve Tartaglia. He's pulling the ship together, and I'm just going to try to ride as long as I can today.
Antron, we've got the run yesterday where your helmet literally goes into the windscreen. What happened to that chain?
The master link broke, and when the master link broke, it broke at the right time between first and second gear, and it sent me that's three G's that I just went to a dead stop, look at my bike like it's endoed, and my helmet hit the windshield so hard. I actually got a little bruise on my neck and everything else, but I'm just going to tough it out. I only raced for 7 seconds, so I think I could be a strong soldier for that.
All right, good luck.
Thank you.
Light will go to Phil Burkhart, 4.78 seconds, 326 miles an hour, and Burkhart will be the only member of the CSK team to finish in the top 10 this year as he moves on to second round competition. Hear the crowd cheering in the background, probably one of the cars going back to the pit area. And there is the far end where Phil is getting out of the car. Meanwhile, back at the starting line, that is Ron Capps. He'll go up against Tim Wilkerson when we come back.
How to almost win a championship three times, and last year was a heartbreaker, but I can tell you it's going to feel more of a relief than anything else. I can't wait for that feeling. Someday, I hope it happens. I don't think I understand how big it's going to be.
So now, as the burnouts occur, there is Ron Capps. No pressure here, folks. If Capps loses, he's done again. So close, but yet so far. He has to win this round to stay in competition. Take a look at the points as of right now, and you can see what's at stake.
Yeah, and the key there, he has no backup for the record, so it's going to be awfully tough for him to win the championship. But what he wants to do is get this round win, which would put him up against John in the next round. So, you know, we talked with Ron on NHRA today. I mean, he's really feeling good. I mean, calm, I think, focused. And his driving's been great pretty much all year long. We asked him if he thinks he has the car. He does. They were able to run a 472 in the third session in qualifying, which they basically called their number, which made Ed McCullough feel good and Ron feel great. They tried to step it up in the previous, or the next session. The clutch just didn't work right, fell off a little bit, but he still feels that they've got a race car that can win the day.
The difference has been over the last three races, Ron Capps has lost in the first round at each of them, and that has what put them in this position. Last year, he had more round wins than champion Gary Selzy, lost the championship. In 1998, he had more race wins than John Force and lost the championship. And there is Force down the starting line. Look at him pacing. You'd think after 13 championships, he'd be used to this. And the win light goes to Capps, and he's still alive. 4.75 seconds. Both cars run 330 miles an hour, and that's the best Tim Wilkerson's run all weekend long.
Talking back with Ed the Ace McCullough, your assessment of round number one. Got the win, and that's the key.
Yeah, we got it, 475.
That was awful close. Is that about what you wanted out of the car, Ace?
We needed to run a 75. That's what we're trying to run.
We're right by the starter. We're going to let Ed the Ace go, but he obviously knows what's up at stake. It's John Force.
And they will have lane choice. His 475 is better than John's 480 elapsed time. Waiting for him to climb out of the cockpit. There he is. He'll be breathing a little easier. He knows he's still in the chase.
There's a piece of something right in the middle of my lane in the shutdown area. It probably broke the body.
He's saying there was a piece of something out in the shutdown area.
Yeah.
Tell him I know we only got 2 lanes. A lot of work.
Take another look at it. Ron Capps was stuck right down the middle of that lane, but so was Tim Wilkerson. That was just a great side-by-side drag race. You see the piece right over there just come flying off the side of that race car. Obviously, he felt that it was on the track and just ran it over, which probably he could have been. But take a look at how close this was. Tim Wilkerson had a slight advantage off the starting line, and like we said, both cars were stuck right down the middle. This was a good race. Tim's car actually washed out towards the wall a little bit, which might have cost him a little bit ET, and if it did, it probably could have possibly cost him the race.
There's the Valvoline winner's cam. 330 miles an hour for both career best speeds. Gary?
330?
Yeah, 330 for both of you. You're talking when you climbed out of the car about something possibly breaking. What happened?
Well, maybe in trouble here. I'm coasting down. I don't know who won, but here's a piece as big as a football right in the middle of my lane. And it's a good thing it didn't damage our body. I don't know what it was. Piece of something pretty big right in the middle of the lane. I'm sure we can see it from the West Covina cam up there as I'm coming down there. Hopefully it didn't break anything. But besides that, hey, it's hard to get motivated. I'm telling you, you know, after Force One, I mean, people ask what it's like. And Gary, you get out and ask us, you know, we can't win the championship now. We can try for everything else. But when you put every single bit of everything you got into something, I mean, all those people at home watching know what we do and what my guys do. I mean, you wake up in the morning, you go to bed. I mean, you've heard it before, but every bit of everything you have, it's all you think about. I don't mean to take up time, the guys behind me running, but that's how bad it hurts. So we're going to try for a second, try and win the race. It's hard to get motivated right now, but, you know, that's it.
We'll see you against Force next round.
And while you were finishing up, Mike Ashley was all over the racetrack, hit the blocks, then scraped the wall on the right side. I don't think Tony's time is going to be allowed because Mike was actually out on because of the red light, and he didn't even probably know that he went red. You can see all the body damage. Let's go through this again.
Wow, he did about everything wrong that you could do. He went and red-lighted, then he's basically the car's going to drift over towards the center, and he lets it drift across the center line, which is an automatic disqualification right there. Takes out the top-end blocks, and then to add insult to injury, drives it over to the other side and tags the wall. Tough break because Brian Corradi had that car running pretty good. It's been running very well for the last few runs.
One more real speed look at it. And Mike Ashley's season is over with a lot of damage on both sides of the race car. And there's Tony Pedregon.
Glove there, Tim.
So he's out of it. Let's update the points. It's right where it was before with Ron Capps going to go up against John Force in the second round. Robert Height will have lane choice over Tommy Johnson Jr. Mike, anything out of the ordinary going on?
Looks like normal maintenance, something we didn't see from this team at the Winter Nationals. If you remember when they set the fire bottles off and had to change the bodies before going into the final round, this team looks awfully good. And you got to remember, when they won that race in Pomona, they came from the bottom half of the field, were terrible in qualifying, but really got together on race day. The team looks good today, though.
All right, let's take a look at our funny car ladder presented by Lucas Oil, and you'll see that Tony Pedregon will have lane choice. I'm not sure that's going to hold up. I think that run's going to be disallowed, guys. And then we'll double check on that one. Phil Burkhardt will have the lane choice over Gary Denchum. And then on the other side, we already mentioned, it would be Robert Height and Ron Capps with the lane choice in those all important matchups. Stay with us when we come back. It'll be time for Pro Stock and Pro Stock Motorcycle here at Auto Club Raceway.
Summit KB Racing team is, man, they're the best, and I love them. Man, I feel like I want to win this thing.
And, of course, that was 2 weeks ago when Jason Lyne clinched his first Pro Stock Championship. We're at Auto Club Raceway for the final stop on the 23 race NHRA Powerade Drag Racing Series. Let's get you caught up on what happened in first round of action of Pro Stock here. First up, it would be Greg Stanfield in the left lane, Dave Connolly in the right lane, and you can see that Stanfield went red, his sixth foul of 2006. Connolly would run it through at 6.68 seconds, 207 miles an hour. Then next up would be Jake Coughlin and Ron Krischer, and Jake gets all kinds of tire shake, has to get out of it. Krischer takes an easy win, 6.69 seconds, 206 miles an hour.
Go on board, watch when he lets the clutch out. Right turn, tire shake. Man, that was severe, and obviously you had to get out of the throttle.
Check your fillings, Jake. You may need them repacked. Also, it was Tom Martino going red in the left lane up against Mike Edwards. Edwards set a track speed record with this run, 6.70 the elapsed time. And you see the speed there, 208.14 miles an hour. And then one of the biggest upsets of the round, we saw Kurt Johnson, his eighth reaction time loss of 2006. Northrop goes 6.71 seconds to the quicker, but losing 6.69 for KJ. That would bring us up to Greg Anderson. He would set a new track elapsed time record in that left lane against Bob Pinella, 6.641, 208 miles an hour. Question would be, how long would it stand up? Alan J. Johnson came to the line against Erica Enders. Erica gave it a good run, but Allen over in the left lane, 6.67 seconds, 206, takes the win light and ends Erica's season. And then it was Jason Line up against Jim Yates, the number one qualifier in the left lane. If you said both track records, you'd be right. 6.634, 208.68 miles an hour. And that would bring us to the last pair, V. Gaines against Tommy Lee. Gaines would get it in a 669 at 207. And you could tell he got the win with a 002 reaction time.
Watch Tommy Lee, just like his teammate Jed Coffin, the car makes a right-hand turn. He's able to reel it in because it didn't shake the tires as bad. But I think that movement right off the starting line probably cost him the race. Watch that left front tire just carrying as the thing moved all over the starting line, and he watches V. Gaines get in the next round.
All right, let's take a look at our Pro Stock Ladder presented by Lucas Oil, and it will be Jason Line and V. Gaines with the lane choice on one side. Then over on the other, it will be Greg Anderson and Alan Johnson with the lane choice there. And let's shift gears. A little bit of Pro Stock Motorcycle. Dave Reif has caught up with Andrew Hines.
1 year ago, it was Andrew Hines' teammate G.T. Tonglet heading into round number one that he needed to keep his point lead. This year, it's Antron Brown with a very, well, looks like a reflective Andrew Hines right now.
Yeah, I'm just kind of sitting here trying to relax as much as possible, and I'm just going to take things as they fall. I'm just focused on racing my round and taking my momentum from Las Vegas and trying to transfer it over here to the Pomona.
You had an engine in this bike that you liked since Sunday at Indianapolis. It expired in qualifying. Any concerns?
No, there's no concerns. This motor is just as good. It's just another one in the series. The one that blew up was 122. This is 123. It's a spitting image of the one that went south on us yesterday, but it ran real strong in fourth qualifier, and we got her tuned up a little more in this first round of eliminations.
Doing everything he can to try and the three times champion Cove.
Thanks, Dave. And guess what's coming up when we come back? That's right. It'll be time to see if Antron Brown can keep his championship hopes alive. Or will Andrew Hines claim his third straight title? Stay with us. We're coming right back to Pomona.
A century so young.
Back here at Auto Club Raceway at Pomona, ready for first round action in Pro Stock Motorcycle, and a very, very important moment for that man right there. Antron Brown must beat Ryan Schnitz to keep his championship hopes alive. Let's take a look at our Pro Stock Motorcycle ladder presented by Lucas Oil. You can see Andrew Hines is the number one qualifier. He has Tom Bradford in the opening round of action. If we go over onto the other side, you will see Antron in the number 10 qualifying position. He does not have lane choice in this matchup with Ryan Schnitz. Schnitz is the defending event winner here. This has been a tough weekend for Antron. He's got to rise to the occasion, Mike.
He definitely does, but I'll tell you, in elapsed time in qualifying, the bikes are pretty evenly matched. So obviously, you know, Antron's going to be focused on the lights, and we've seen a lot of red lights this year. Hopefully they'll both go green.
Schnitz is the one that goes red. Antron runs it through 7.15 seconds and only 184 miles an hour. So again, he's still not getting the kind of elapsed time and speeds that we have seen from Andrew Hines, the other championship contender. But he gets a free pass here, courtesy of Ryan Schnitz going red.
Antron definitely dodged a bullet because Ryan Schnitz made his best run of the week, and that 7:05 was a great pass by the team. But unfortunately, he's going home. Antron's going into the next round. Take another look at it. Just by 0.007 of a second, Ryan Schnitz goes red, but it doesn't matter. It could be 0.007. At that point, Antron gets the win. But like I said, Ryan Schnitz made a great run. That's a tough loss for him, but definitely good for this man. Let's watch one more time. That thing carries the front end up all the way down the racetrack for a little ways, drops it back down, and Antron just tucks in and takes it into the next round.
Well, Antron, this time the red light's in the other lane. You didn't have to worry about that. You are still alive mathematically going to that second round. Sigh of relief?
It's definitely a sigh of relief. We needed that run because yesterday we didn't know where we were at. And, you know, this goes to my team. We're not giving up yet. This U.S. Army staying strong, and we're going to keep on pushing. And all credit goes to my crew chief, Steve Tartaglia. Now he's got a run on this deal. So now we can tune it up. And I think we're going to be a lot stronger for the next round, Gary. So don't count us out yet.
We're not counting anybody out.
So back at the starting line, it is time for Andrew Hines. He has already seen what Antoine Brown has done. Here are the current point standings. He wins, it goes back to 43.
It's all about staying focused right here. The key is red lights. Andrew's been one of the best at not red lighting this season, but that doesn't mean he hasn't done it. It's a situation like Antron. You saw Antron just went out there and had a decent light. 0:30 reaction time, that's very good for him. He's obviously able to do a lot quicker. Andrew needs to do the same thing. Just get a good light, not a great light, and let the horsepower of that Harley Davidson hopefully carry him into the next round.
Red light, Hines. Can you believe this? He throws away a 7:02. Tom Bradford, this was a rematch from Las Vegas round one. Andrew beat Tom there. Tom beats him here. Dave, what's the thought down there?
Well, I can best believe that Matt Hines is as stunned as the rest of us. Did you guys even get a chance to talk about that round?
Well, that's what racing's all about. You know, we don't race 14 races or 15 races.
Unbelievable, though.
Well, hopefully Craig Treble can do the job next round.
Craig Treble, of course, will be taking on Antoine Brown with lane choice, I believe.
Well, right now, Antoine Brown, look at this. They have just heard the news. He is only 23 points behind. So that means if he goes two more rounds, the championship will be Antron's. Let's go to Gary.
Well, obviously, your nerves now are going to undergo a severe test. What are the emotions, Andrew?
It's whatever will be. I got our best Suzuki out there, Craig Treble. It's got to run Antron next round, I believe. Is that right? No, wait. I don't know.
Gino Scallon.
Either way, you know, our Screaming Eagle Vance Nines team's doing a pretty good job, and hopefully we'll sneak out here with this championship. I just flat out blew it.
Not much more can be said, and sneak out may be the operative phrase for the rest of the day, and let's clarify, it will be Craig Treble, not Gino Scali, that goes up against Antron next round.
And Treble is going to have the lane choice with a 7:03 to Antron's 7:15, so they've got to find some horsepower and a combination that's going to get that bike tuned up and running quicker. Remember, the best he's run all weekend has been a 7:10. Take a look at the Pro Stock Motorcycle Ladder presented by Lucas Oil. Bradford has lane choice over Scali, Matt Gadara over Sean Gann. And then over on the other side, there is the big one. Craig Treble with the lane choice, as we said, over Antron. Matt Smith with the lane choice over GT Tonkin. And there's Antron. They are in the hunt still. Top Fuel is up next when we come back to Auto Club Raceway at Pomona.
Honda, the company that defines performance in motorcycling, ATVs, personal watercraft, and scooters. McDonald's and National. Green means go.
And back here at Auto Club Raceway at Pomona at the Automobile Club of Southern California Finals, we are getting ready for second round action of Top Fuel. It will be Morgan Lucas in the left lane, Melanie Troxell over in the right lane. Let's get you caught up in case you're just tuning in. Back in the opening round, of course, the championship battle is what we're focusing on. Doug Coletta was in the right lane, Alan Bradshaw in the left, and you saw Bradshaw go up in smoke. Coletta takes the win easily, 4.48 seconds. And then Tony Schumacher, the number two qualifier. Again, tire smoke in the left lane for David Baca. And another 4:48 elapsed time for Schumacher. So this is the way it shapes up as we take a look at our Top Fuel ladder presented by Lucas Oil. And you can see who has the lane choice with the arrow.
No easy matchup for any of our title contenders, as you saw J.R. Todd and Hot Rod Fuller going head-to-head with them.
Now we get ready for Melanie Troxell, and then over in the left lane will be Morgan Lucas with an onboard camera. Morgan got charged with oil last round. It cost him 15 points, dropped him out of the top 10 even though he won the round. Take a look at his problems that he's had all weekend long.
Yeah, well, as he started out the weekend pretty good, making some clean runs, but boy, the last three runs it really had major issues with oil down to the tire.
That was, and then this is session four, Saturday. They have heard a lot of parts, and right now, he needs to win this round to get back into the top 10 ahead of Corey McLenathan and Hillary Will. Those two cars have already been eliminated.
As far as Melanie Droxel goes, some major clutch adjustments here as they came under the bridge on Auto Club Raceway. Obviously trying to adjust that car to get it down the racetrack. A pretty critical race for Melanie Droxel because not only does this team want to finish strong, but the possibility of racing point leader Doug Gallet. And keep in mind, Melanie Droxel, a teammate to Tony Schumacher and Alan Johnson, would certainly like to see that.
See Morgan getting ready to flip the visor down. There he goes. And a little flame coming out of the back of Morgan's car again. And Melanie goes 4.52 seconds, 329 miles an hour. And that oil down in the first round was oh so costly to Morgan Lucas. Instead of being on the stage tomorrow night, he's going to be sitting in the audience in 11th place.
That's a tough break for Morgan and the team. But I tell you, Melanie Troxell, she looks as good as she did at the beginning of the season when she won here to Winter Nationals. I tell you, Richard Hogan's got a good tune-up on that race car. Let's go on board with Morgan, see if his engine goes flat at the end. You heard it just before the finish line. It just goes flat. No, that's an indication. It actually hurts a little bit earlier before it actually starts seeing the effects of that, and the engine just kind of flattens out on the other end, and that probably allowed Melanie to get to the next round.
That's Morgan, and there is Tony Schumacher back in the stadium. He'll be in the third pair to come up. We've already seen the first. The second one will be Brandon Bernstein and Larry Dixon, and there is the Miller Lite Top Fueler. It's apropos, it is very appropriate when you think about it, Miller leaving the sport at the end of this race, that the beer wagons should go head-to-head one more time. Believe it or not, if you haven't been with us before, it is more important when these two came to the line for them to beat each other than it was to win the race. So as the burnouts are complete, gives us a chance to tell you about Monday night as ESPN brings you an NFC South showdown. Cadillac Williams, Tampa Bay Buccaneers against Steve Smith, Keyshawn Johnson, Carolina Panthers. Is it Monday yet? Monday Night Football on ESPN at 8:30 Eastern. It's available in high definition on ESPN HD and in Spanish on ESPN Deportes. Call your cable operator or satellite provider today. And you can see the sun beating down on the track. 93 degrees.
Talked about the beer matchup here. I mean, it's been a great run for Larry Dixon and the Miller team. I mean, it's the only sponsor that he's ever known since he came on board about, 10 years or so ago, and won two championships with them, a number of national events, I think over 35. But what a great relationship this team has had with this sponsor. I'm sure Larry would like nothing more than to be able to win the race today, because if he does, that means he also took out the Budweiser King along the way. But right now, Brandon Bernstein and Tim Richards have a very good race car over in that right-hand lane.
Well, Larry has not won a race this year, and the last time he went winless in a season, 1998. Kenny Bernstein, familiar position. He always likes to be off that side where you can see the car launch with the tree in the background. The beer wagons goes to Budweiser. 4.49 seconds the elapsed time, 330 miles an hour, and Tim Richards has got this car hauling the mail.
Boy, has he done a great job with that car. I mean, he's in test mode, but he's got to be loving it right now.
For Larry Dixon, this will be the lowest he'll finish in the points since 1999 when he was eighth. Right now, he's in seventh spot. We've got to take a break. When we come back, the heavy hitters, the championship contenders, Tony Schumacher. He'll be third out in the four pairs, and then he'll be followed by Doug Coletta, the points leader. Stay with us. Back here at Auto Club Raceway at Pomona. Schumacher is back in the right lane. These two guys are 2-2 this season, head-to-head. This is the current points. Right now, what has to happen, Tony has to win this round and then hope that J.R. Todd takes Doug Coletta out, because he needs Coletta to lose and then advance to the championship round went three rounds further than Doug.
Talked to Tony Schumacher just before they took the car to the lanes. It was the usual mantra. He says, we win the race, then we'll go for a record in the finals. That's all he's been saying all day long. Alan Johnson said conditions still conducive to running in the high 440s, but he said the real drama will begin if Coletta loses to Ty. Dave Reap.
And when it comes to team cars, Doug Coletta on an island all by himself, his two teammates are gone. Mitchell being a team car to Tony Schumacher. As soon as Alan Johnson watched her complete her run at 452, he immediately came back to the car. There's a flap on the top. You open that up, reach down in there. That's where the clutch timers are. And Alan Johnson did make a last-minute clutch adjustment. Make sure they get this round win.
Notice the sun becoming a factor, glaring into the eyes. Here we go. Saw the flash of flames in Rod Fuller's car, and that meant it was all over for him. Tony goes 4.47 seconds, 328 miles an hour. The championship battle is now in the lap of Doug Coletta.
Let's take another look at the run. This was a great pass. Right side of your screen, you see High Rod Fuller. He started pushing a head gasket out early. By half track, it was all over, but it was going to be pretty tough to beat Tony Schumacher anyway, because he was running a 447 at 328 miles per hour, and they love what they see.
And so that brings us to the final pair here in second round action of Top Fuel. Ron Tobler to the right. He has won two Top Fuel championships with Shirley Muldowney, his wife, behind the wheel. He's on the verge of winning a championship for that man right there, Doug Coletta. Let's go to the far end. Gary?
Tony Schumacher getting those earplugs out. The mouth guard goes away. The hat comes on. And now you march one round closer, keeping the pressure on Doug Coletta. Your thoughts?
Well, I think he's got to sit back there and watch that happen. You know, I had to do it first round. That boy don't make mistakes, so he's an outstanding driver. You know, and all we can do is sit back and watch. You know, when you qualify one and two on opposite sides of the ladder, you can't meet to the finals. And unfortunately, if we do meet in the finals, he's your world champ. So, hey, man, Army did a great job. That was a bad to the bone run right there under pressure, and Doug got to watch it. So we'll see what happens. Get to watch it on the TV right here and enjoy myself for a few minutes.
And if Coletta wins, it's two rounds for Schumacher and a record. That's what it would take. We'll watch. We talked to Ron Tobler just a short time ago. He said the nerves are good. The key right now, he said, try to maintain if we can. He knows that Tony Schumacher's got a tough side of the ladder. Tony goes up against Bernstein in the next round.
Thank you, Gary, and you summed it up excellently on what the two scenarios are for these two racers. Let's take a look at college basketball, because it begins Monday night with regional final from the CBE Classic on ESPN2. And then there's more action on ESPN2. It continues Monday night with the NIT season tip-off, the Indiana Hoosiers, the Lafayette Leopards, Dick's Sporting Goods, NIT season tip-off, 9 Eastern on ESPN2 and ESPN2 HD. So the engines have fired down the starting line, and here's Doug through the water box. This will be the first meeting between Doug Coletta and J.R. Todd head-to-head. Todd has been a thorn in the side of Tony Schumacher, and isn't it ironic? We mentioned it in the first round as you take a look at the updated points. Right now, the biggest J.R. Todd fan is Tony Schumacher.
And despite the fact that guys like Ron Tobler and Doug Coletta have nerves of steel, and they say that it is just another run, believe me, it's not. There is some second guessing and some additional guessing on top of that. Just like I talked about Alan Johnson reaching in under the body, tweaking the clutch timers on that car, so too has Ron Tobler. His clutch timers located just in front of the dashboard for Doug Coletta. Watched him make one, two, possibly even three adjustments there as the previous three pair of Top Fuel cars went down the racetrack.
Thanks for the update, Dave.
That's one of the advantages to being getting to pick last in the session. I mean, you can sit there and watch the competition, see what they do. One of the key things they look at, what we always talk about, is that 8-mile speed. That gives you a real good indication how good that track is and how aggressive you can get on that clutch setting.
Alan Johnson, normally he'd already be back in the pits. So would that man. But they're both watching because they want to see what happens right here.
green light goes to Doug Coletta. 4.58 seconds, 330 miles an hour. The elapsed time falls off dramatically from what they ran in the first round. That's irrelevant. Ron Tobler right now has the battle of losing lane choice in the semifinals. The battle for Tony Schumacher is he must now hope that Coletta loses in the semifinals. He must also go on to win the race, Tony does, and set a national elapsed time record to win the championship.
Wow, Doug was there for the taking. J.R. Todd had 500ths of a second advantage off the starting line. You don't see that very often. And then when Doug hit the throttle, it just didn't move. I didn't see any cylinders out. He backpedaled there. Looked like maybe it went into a little bit of tire shake. Actually pedaled the car, and then it ran good through the middle. He's run 275 and then 330 at the other end. But that little backpedal early in the run could have cost him had J.R. Todd not smoked the tires.
Well, there he is. Let's find out, Gary.
Doug Coletta, 458, but it won't give you lane choice against Troxell's 52. How significant will that be to you and Ron Tober and the team?
Yeah, it's hard to say. You know, the thing got out there and it felt like it shook a little bit, and I hope I didn't screw the guys up with having to pedal it, but you never know. Just happy to be past second round and going to third, so we'll see what happens. But my, you know, Ron, the whole Mac Tools Redline car, so far so good.
Thanks.
Well, the drama is not done yet. There is Tony. He's got a smile on his face. He knows it's still alive. He has a chance. It's tougher, but he still has a chance. Hey, guess what? The drama's not going to end. Funny car, second round. John Force up against Ron Capps. And Capps has owned Force this year. That's right. We'll explain when we come back.
Like to beat him, what's it like to beat him for a championship? And right now, Force wants it back. And to beat them for a championship when that team's at its best, I mean, you can you could pretty much say that that's probably going to be the most important thing, is just knowing that you beat John Force at his best.
That, of course, was Ron Capps. He and John Force will be the second pair to come to the starting line here in second round competition in Funny Car. Right now, it will be Phil Burkhardt in the right lane, Gary Densham over in the left lane.
So Gary Densham actually out to backpedal, win the pedal fest in the first round to get to this position. Phil Burkhardt here coming off that win back in Reading. The cars look pretty good. I mean, he's been making a consistent run. They've been running in the 470 range. Crew chief Chris Cunningham, I think, is doing a pretty good job. They have lane choice. They've chosen that right-hand lane, which everybody has in both Top Fuel and Funny Car, so I like their chances here.
Coming to the line, Gary Densham has not been to a semifinal this year. He could make his first if he can get past Phil Burkhardt. We've already documented that Phil will be the only Checker Shucks Cragen team entry to be in the top 10, as Del Worsham is 11th in the points and has been eliminated from competition today. The pedal, and Burkhardt gets down the quarter mile first, 5.18 seconds at 283 miles an hour, and he moves into the semifinals.
Well, once again, Gary Densham, just like he did in the first round, went out of ways and then spun the tires. Unfortunately for him this time, Phil Burkhardt went a little bit further down track than he did before he started spinning the tires, and Phil was able to get it to recover and get the win. Let's take a look at this. Car launches good. It drifts over to the right side of the groove, but he's still in the groove at that point. Then it starts moving around a little bit, puts some cylinders out because it was spinning the tires at that point. Gets out of the throttle, gets back on it, hooks back up, does a nice job to get him into the semifinals.
So now we've come to one of those dramatic moments. John Force has his own destiny in his hands. If he beats Ron Capps in this round, he wins his 14th championship. If Capps wins, then it is still up for grabs between Capps and Robert Hight. Force would not be eliminated from the championship, of course. As we take a look at this crowd, look at that. They are lined up 5 and 6 deep on the fence. All right, let's talk about John's situation. All he has to do is win this round. For Ron Capps, it's a lot more difficult. He's got to win and set a record in the process. And
win the entire race. So let's talk more. Dave, what do you got?
Well, meanwhile, Ron Capps has a pretty huge mountain to climb. The only damage from that piece of debris in the racetrack, a broken front tire, they changed that. That's the good news. The bad news is, obviously, the mountain they do have to climb. The place they've lost a lot of points this year is in qualifying. Qualifying, it seems that they've given up in terms of having a consistent race car. And earlier this year, it was a consistent race car. You can best believe that Eddie Ace McCall is probably not going to stray too far from that. He'd rather have a car that goes A to B here because, as we've seen this year as well, John Force is prone to making mistakes. So if John beats him, I'm sure he will be the first one to shake his hand.
There is Ed McCullough.
Well, you know, and that's a good strategy. I mean, you know, basically John hasn't beat Capps since Phoenix began the season. I mean, Ron Capps has owned him. Ed McCullough's been making, you know, making good runs. They have lane choice right now. So, I mean, I think there's a slight advantage. Obviously, you can never count on John Force and Austin Coyle. But, I mean, you know, this should be a good race.
Say, John Force is the funny car champion. The family at the starting line, the crowd on their feet, and John has done it again. You saw Capps getting all crossed up out at about mid-track, and it was over from that point on. As Force goes 4.74 seconds, 326 miles an hour. Dave?
Time as Austin Coyle drives away quickly. I know they've got more work to do. Congratulations.
Thank you, sir. That's mighty nice to be able to pull it off again for the however many times, 16 for me, 14 for John. It's always big fun running for the championship, and I just wish my wife was here, but she isn't feeling too good this week.
Where do the other two championships come for that man? Frank Hawley, back in the Chi-Town Hustler days.
1982 and 1983, to be exact, as John takes off the helmet. Gary, it's all yours.
The fireworks, the check, the trophy, the Powerade. John Force has been through it so many times in his career. John, tell us about getting business done. Was the killer instinct there today? You talked about it at Las Vegas.
Yeah, I've always had the killer instinct. But I got the best bunch of guys, led by Austin Coyle and Bernie Federle. And they make all this happen. And don't forget Jimmy Prock and Robert and John Medlin and Eric Medlin. But if you look at the side of that race car, if you just take a shot of that race car, with all those sponsors' names on there, Castrol and Ford and AAA of Southern Cal, the list goes on and on. And I think the car did the talking today, and I think I'll just pray for Robert, and I'll let it go at that. Okay.
A somewhat subdued, surprisingly, John Force savors a 14th championship.
Let's go back. He's walking over towards Ron Capps. Let's hold on here. Let's see. I'm sure that that's going to be a very warm moment. These two guys really care about each other genuinely. They talk a lot on the phone. And oh, so many times, Capps has wanted to win and just hasn't been able to beat John Force. Let's go back and take a look at the championship run.
Left side of your screen, you see Ron Capps start to get a little bit loose and drive that thing right out of the groove. At that point, all he could do was watch John Force, the greatest funny car racer ever, greatest drag racer ever, basically, with all the wins, go on to his 14th championship. What a great job.
John goes 4.78 seconds. That is a new track record. He just spanked it.
For the 20th consecutive year, John Force has at least one victory in a season. Nobody has ever had that grand success.
We'll just keep doing what we do, and at the end, somebody wins. That's what we live for. That's what we dream, to win, to be a champion. For me to win the 14th this year, it's probably as important as my first.
Down with Ashley Force, Courtney Force, and, of course, Lori Force. A 14th championship. Lori, you've been with this man so many years. How do you think he's feeling right now, and how proud are you of him?
Oh, very proud. This is a pretty tough one to do. You know, he didn't have the good lane, and all the cars ahead of him were smoking the tires. So he had a job on his hands. He had to get Capps out, and he did great. And I know he's thrilled.
And correct me if I'm wrong. We've been watching your life on television. He's had a long year.
Yeah, we've all had a long year. You know, with John, a normal year is like 7 years in our lifetime.
And for all the girls, I'm sure it's been a long year for them, too. Congratulations to the Force family.
And the contrasting emotion of the disappointment of being so close once again in the career of Ron Capps. John came over and talked to you there. Can you share anything? I know you guys have been friends for a long time, Ron.
Yeah. He just said, keep my chin up. You know, he doesn't have a whole lot of years left in him, he says.
How hard is that to do right now?
It's ridiculous to try to. You know, we're paid to put our face on down here and thank our sponsors. But I feel like I got punched in the gut a little bit. You know, all my guys do. I got to represent my guys, and I'm the one that gets to talk. But it's devastating. We had them. We just let it go, you know. For whatever reason, the bottom line is we just let it go. And it's no other reason than it's just tough competition. But to have it that close, you just never know if you're going to be in this position again. I know the points chase next year is going to be different. You might have a shot at it. But to be so close like we were, devastating. But, you know. Brute guys will be back.
We always appreciate how candid this man is, win or lose.
Well, he's finished second in the championship three times. He'll be third this year as we get Tony Pedregon in the left lane, Jack Beckman in the right lane. More on that championship run, but let's watch this one. To shut off. Beckman almost hit the wall and he wins the race. There's Whit Bazemore watching back at the starting line. A 5.06 beats a 5.22.
Wow, Jack Beckman. It was almost like what we saw with Ron Capps in the previous run. He basically drove it out of the groove. Watch left side of your screen. Car's going to move way over out of the groove. Gets it loose and shuts it off. But evidently, Tony Pedregon, when he put a cylinder out, might have lost a blower belt and possibly cost him the race.
Dave?
Down with Whit Bazemore, 85 days away from your Top Fuel debut. Top 10 in Funny Car this year, despite missing the last five races. Watching the old team just keep the beat going.
Yeah, I think they had a big-time gift that run. The guys, Todd and Phil, are doing an outstanding job. And honestly, Jack is coming around. I mean, that right there was obviously a pretty obvious error on his part, but it's a great, great team, and I want to see him do well, so I'm glad the win light came on.
We look forward to your debut. The man who signed Jack Beckman's Funny Car license.
All right, thanks, Dave. We still have one more pair of Funny Car, as you can see there's Jack at the far end of the track. And now Robert Height and Tommy Johnson Jr. will duke it out. The championship hopes are over for Robert, but he will finish second in this year's championship chase. That is no matter what happens in this round of competition, because he leads Ron Capps coming into the round by 1 point. Meanwhile, back in the pits, there's Doug Coletta getting the parachutes ready, and the rest of the team doing the 90 or 75-minute turnaround maintenance, and it looks like everything's pretty routine, unlike yesterday when they were...
But I guarantee you they're intently looking at that computer data right now to try to figure out why that car shook and was so soft at the hit of the throttle. Could have possibly been a mechanical problem that they may have to address, but normal maintenance as far as just putting rods and pistons and supercharging everything back on, because obviously they didn't hurt any parts.
While that continues, we mentioned the fact we were going to put a period on Funny Car with Ron Capps. One of the things you have to remember why Ron is so devastated is not only has he finished third, you know, or second three times, and now third this year. Remember, he won five races this year, more than John Force. John's won two so far. And he'll have the most wins this season out of anybody in the class.
And the thing is, we talked about how consistent of a race car he had, too, and yet, you know, he still lost the championship. So, yeah, it's a tough break.
Well, I think Dave hit it with the qualifying points. That really did hurt him this year. No problem for Robert Height. 4.75, the elapsed time. He will not have up against John in the semifinals. Woo, Robert's bouncing it to a stop. He'll make it before the sand, but that's a little hard on the old Goodyears. So John will have lane choice by 1/100th of a second over Robert.
Well, you know, Robert had lane choice in that run and actually chose the left-hand lane. He was the first one to do that, maybe because he saw his boss make a nice run in that ahead of him.
We'll finish on the track. We'll go down here.
So, while we've got a moment here, as they wait to get the helmets off, let's take time out for our Checker Shucks and Cragen traction area, and it's the shutdown area.
Well, and that's a portion of the track after the finish line that the drivers use to slow the machines following a run. The reason we bring it up here, the shutdown area here at Pomona is relatively short, and as you can see, normally at every race, we see some cars going to the sand. Topped off by this one by Del Worsham was big time going in the sand and over the nets. There's three nets on the other end to try to catch these if they make it past the sand. You should look at Mike Strasburg after that great 457 run. He puts her in there, but they pulled it out and were able to get that thing cleaned up in time to come for the next session. And then Terry Haddock in qualifying, even though he had tried to get both shoots out, one didn't blossom. Situation where he just maybe didn't get on the brakes quite early enough, and he noses it into the sand a little bit, all because we got a short shutdown area.
All right, let's take a look at our semifinal matchups. Jack Beckman, believe it or not, a 506 actually gets you lane choice. Like we said, Beckman's living a charmed life right now. Won 2 weeks ago, got married last week, and here he is going to the semifinals with lane choice with a 506. And we mentioned John's got it by 100 over Robert Hyde. And there is John. They'll bring him back in front of the crowd here and let the crowd salute him. And it is a huge crowd here. That's the overflow section right there at the very far end of the racetrack. Everything else is jammed packed. Stay with us. We'll talk to Robert Hyde and Pro Stock Action when we return. Is Tom Compton, president of the National Hot Rod Association, who just gave John a hug. And there are his daughters, wife Laurie, and the celebration continues down at the starting line now as he collects his 14th NHRA Powerade Funny Car Championship. There's the check for $400,000. The bonus money, by the way, is shared equally by all three team cars. The crew gets, no matter which car they're working on, they share in that bonus money.
What a great job is Bob Fry, the MC, presenting the, checking the trophy. I'll tell you what, 14 championships. What can you say about this man? Former truck driver that came from nowhere to win it all.
There in that second round and put this thing out of reach.
No, you can win a lot of championships, and you give credit to your team, Austin Coyle, Bernie Federley and the kids, Jimmy Prock, John Medlin, Robert Height, Eric Medlin, because we all did it as a team. Naturally, Castrol, a Ford Motor Company, you know, Brand Source, AAA of Southern California Auto Club. Look at those suites up there. Unbelievable. And Mac Tool along the road here. What's really amazing, it's not just about championships to me. Maybe I'm getting old and emotional, but it's about the kids that fight the fight. Because my own kids are coming into the fight, and it's going to be tough next year for one of my little ones to fight this fight. But what I'm saying is, the fans are what give you heart. Well, let me tell you something. Robert Height's got more heart than anybody, and Eric Medlin, and they all fought this battle. But in my heart, the kid that's fought me for years, that made me sweat and made me sick, that was Ron Capps. And in my heart, Ron Capps, you're the champion. Yes.
So, John, in a very emotional moment, tribute to Ron Capps. And there is Ashley. I guess he sort of let it out of the bag that she's going funny car racing next year, although it's not officially announced. And there is Austin already with John Medlin back in the pits. They are working on getting the car ready for semifinal action. And he mentioned Robert Height. Let's check in with Gary.
Well, we know there will be no championship this year for Robert Height, but still second in points and great success in only his second year. But I'm curious about your emotions. When you saw John clinch as you're waiting to go, did things change for you?
Yeah, you know, in some ways it's sort of a relief. You know, I don't ever wish bad luck for him. I don't want him to go out and lose. I didn't wish that Ron Capps had beat him, so my title chances were alive. You know, he's given me this opportunity. And Capps is a tough competitor. I want to congratulate John on a great season and all of four horse racing. We're one big team. AAA of Southern California, they carry the banner, right, with the championship with John. And I'm, you know, my second year, I have nothing to hang my head about. And I won't look back, and I wouldn't change with anything. It's a great season.
We look forward to Robert against John in the next round.
All right, thanks, Gary. Robert will have his day, and back in the Brain Trust Center is, look at this. Yeah, I think when it comes around, it says 14, you bet. And just a few moments ago, in front of a jammed Auto Club Raceway, this was the scene as John Force came through the parade to the starting line area. Stay with us. We're coming right back. The scene just a few moments ago here at Auto Club Raceway, John hoisting his 14th Funny Car Championship trophy. Ben Reiling on the left from Powerade, Tom Compton on the right from the NHRA. And now we get ready for the Factory Hot Rods, where this championship was locked up 2 weeks ago back in Las Vegas. That's V. Gaines. He's in the left lane against Dave Northrup, who has won with that first round win his second round of competition in his pro stock career. He's looking to make it three.
He did it in a hole shot over Kurt Johnson, one of the best in the business. So he was no slouch on the starting line first round. 0-10 reaction time. That's 1/100th of a second from perfect. V. Gaines, so he was 0-02, 2/1000th of a second from perfect. But that's a little close to red light for my taste.
Light in a pair of 670 elapsed times, it goes to V. Gaines, 206 miles an hour. So V makes it into the semifinals. And back in the pit area, there is Angel Sampe helping her teammate Antron Brown. And Gary, you caught up with Antron, I think.
It is feverish activity between rounds for Antron Brown, Steve Tartaglia, and the U.S. Army team. They are making a complete power plant change. We're trying to reach in here as Antron is involved in the work. How close is this? What anxieties may you have going to the next round to keep your hopes alive?
We just got to keep on doing what we're doing. Our team's just working their tail to the bone, and my crew chief, Steve Tartaglia, is just he's putting everything we have at it. I mean, bike, we think, I don't know what happened to the motor that passed or whatever it is, but he's making an engine change because we got to step up. I don't know who we race next round. I think it's Craig Treble. I'm fully confident with this motor that we got in this bike. We won races with it before, so hopefully we can win this race today.
We look forward to it. Thanks. They keep up the hectic work.
All right, thanks, Gary. As you can see, the work continuing back there. We come back out trackside where Mike Edwards will be in the right lane against Alan Johnson in the left lane. Allen, if he wins this round, takes over fifth place from the departed Kurt Johnson. Kurt got beat, as you just heard a few moments ago, in the first round by Dave Northrup.
This is a great matchup here by two teams that have really found a lot of horsepower this year, something that they struggled with the previous season. Mike Edwards has gone 208 miles per hour, but he's been kind of missing on the setups, hasn't ran the ET to match the mile an hour. Alan Johnson in the other lane, he's had the horsepower, but he's also been making good runs. If they both hit the setup, it'll be a good race.
Win light goes to Alan Johnson, 6.67 seconds the elapsed time. And yeah, the team's got to like that, because as we said, that just moved him into fifth place in the championship point standings ahead of Kurt Johnson. Let's take a look at the Valvoline winners camp, show you just how close it was at the stripe. Oh, almost a half a car length. That's 15 1/1000ths of a second. Let's go back to the subject of Pro Stock Motorcycle. Let's check in with Dave Reif.
And Marty, as competitive as the Harley Davidsons and the Suzukis are, it's certainly worth noting that Vance and Hines also happens to build the horsepower for Craig Treble. And we were just talking, do you play a side of the fence, or how do you approach this run against Antron Brown? Are you even thinking spoiler?
Yeah, yes and no. I mean, I'm a Vance and Hines guy. I always have been. Harry Lartigue, he's always been a Vance and Hines guy, but truth be known, Antron and I, we're really good friends. You know, I don't want to beat him, but for Harry and Joanne, we've had such an awful year. And, you know, this bike is really fast this weekend. And, yeah, we would love to win this round. Antron wins this round, kudos to him. You know, he's earned it, because this bike is flying right now, and I'm going to try and do what I can do on the tree. And, you know, just so everybody out there knows, you know, there's probably a lot of rumor going around, oh, Byron tuned up Craig and gave him some killer motor, blah, blah, blah.
Byron Hines hasn't been in our trailer for three races straight, so I think he's at the track, but this is all Harry's tune-up. Harry's done an awesome job, and it's taken 14 races, unfortunately, to get this thing tuned up, but we're in a comfortable place right now, and hopefully it'll get us some sponsorship so we can be back out here next year.
I'll boil it all down. He said, honestly, this race is about my season.
And remember, Antron has to go two more rounds to claim the championship, so he has to get past Treble and one more. Let's go trackside. That's Greg Anderson, left lane. Dead even start with Ron Krischer in the right. But it's not dead even at the finish line. Whoa, another 6.64 second elapsed time. Wife Kim likes it. And Greg goes 208 miles an hour into the semifinals. He'll have lane choice over Alan Johnson with that 664.
Like you said, Marty, was dead even off the start line, but both drivers are pretty late. 081, not real good for pro stock. And if you're going to leave even with Greg Anderson, you're pretty much going to be doing that. You're going to be waving goodbye because that Summit Pontiac makes a lot of horsepower, makes great runs, and he's into the next round.
And before we get to Jason Lyne and Dave Conley, let's talk a little football because Monday night ESPN brings you an NFC South showdown. It's Tampa Bay against the Carolina Panthers. Is it Monday yet? Monday Night Football on ESPN at 8:30 Eastern. It's available in high definition on ESPN HD and in Spanish on ESPN Deportes. So that brings us to our final pair, as we mentioned. It'll be Dave Conley up against Jason Lyne. Dave is going to finish third in the championship chase, no matter whether he wins or loses this round. Of course, Jason clinched his first championship 2 weeks ago. And speaking of championships, there's the hats back to the guys in the pits, number 14 right there.
You're on board with Jason Lyne. I mean, always pressure's off him. He's always won the Powerade Championship the previous race, but he would like to make a statement. He'd like to be able to get a win here, especially against Dave Conley. Dave Conley always races Jason tough.
Well, the irony is both these guys have won four races this year, but Conley had more struggles in qualifying, getting that consistency. Boy, you saw from the onboard camera, it was all Jason Lyne. Conley had the jump at the start, but then there's another 6.64 second elapsed time for that Summit Racing team. And these two guys are just, again, on a collision course for a final round matchup.
Jason did a good job there. I mean, Dave did have a slight advantage off the starting line, but Jason did what he had to do, had an 0.40 reaction time to Dave's 0.31. You're going to need more than that of an advantage off starting line if you're going to want to beat Jason today.
Guess who gets the lane choice in pro stock? If you said the Summit cars, you'd be right, both of them. We're going to take a commercial break. When we come back, it'll be time for Pro Stock Motorcycle. Andrew Hines is a spectator. That's all he can do. Back here at Auto Club Raceway at Pomona, we are already getting set for our first matchup here in second round competition of Pro Stock Bikes. It's Matt Smith left lane, GT Tonglet, the lone remaining Harley over in the right lane. The rider anxious to stage, both have pre-staged.
A little staging duel here in Pro Stock Motorcycle.
We haven't seen this quite a while. Now it's GT moving in. Slight advantage for GT. But the wind light is going to go to Matt. Matt Smith goes 7.11 seconds at 184 miles an hour to take the win. As he coasts on out, let's check the Valvoline winner's cam to show you the difference between a 7.11 and a 7.13. It's almost full bike length.
That's right. It was pretty much on the starting line because it was about 0.04 of a second in the first 60 feet that Matt Smith had over GT.
So one of our semifinalists has been determined. The question now is, who will join Matt Smith? As you can see, the one we have highlighted, that's the all-important one. Antron Brown, Craig Treble has the lane choice there. As we come back to the starting line, it is Tom Bradford in the left lane, Gino Scali over in the right.
Tom Bradford coming off that upset win in the first round over Andrew Hines. Made a good pass, ran that 7.07. He would have been tough to beat. Andrew was going to have to, you know, have a decent lie because Tom Bradford was really good on the tree, 007 in the first round. You know, he's probably going to try to do the same thing right here. I mean, get a good light. I don't know if he wants to be that good because that's too close to red light.
And Scally goes red. For Gino, his fourth foul this year. He throws away a 7:13 elapsed time. You saw Bradford having all kinds of problems with his machine. But again, he gets the break, and he's into the semifinals. Dave Reif.
Down at the starting line, we've already seen Andrew Hines, the Powerade Championship, out of his control, still one pair away before he knows it. Antron Brown still has an opportunity. And Andrew, the anxiety meter, where is it right now?
I'm a little stressed out, but you know, I'm just depending on one of our best Suzukis out here that has a Vance Nines motor in it to do its job and hopefully save a championship for the Screaming Eagle Vance Nines Harley Davidson team.
We will hang with him and find out what the results of that race. Antron Brown, Craig Treble.
And John back in the pits signing autographs and all the pressure off there. Pressure is definitely on out here. It's time for Sean Gann and Matt Gadara to come to the line.
This is a good matchup. I mean, Matt Gadara made a very good run in the first round, that 7:04 victory.
Big run for Gadara with GT Tonglet out. If he wins this round, he takes 10th place. GT's out. Red light, Sean Gann. Gadara runs it through at a 7:04. Gann throws away a 7:03. I believe that's his sixth foul of the season. Yes, it is. So that means that Matt Gadara ends up moving into the number 10 spot on the stage tomorrow night at Palm Springs. GT Tonglet will be in the audience. But now is the most important run of the season for both Antron Brown and Andrew Hines. You get 20 points for each round win. So you know exactly what's at stake. Antron must win this round against Craig Treble and must also then win the next one.
And Antron making that engine change, sometimes you might think you're a little concerned, why, you know, why change the engine? But obviously they did have problems because they slowed down when, but everybody else, what the conditions are, not everybody, but the majority of them were actually stepping up, making their best runs in that first round session. So they knew they got to come back and find some more horsepower somewhere.
These guys have met 19 times. Or I should say 29 times. Antron has won 19 of them. The 10 that he's lost, 5 times on red, everybody's green. Treble drills the tree. And the championship is over. Treble goes 7:06 and look at Andrew Hines.
Take a moment. Now, let it out.
That is freaking awesome. Craig Treble, I gotta thank you so much, but that Vance Nines horsepower overcame any U.S. Army horsepower today, and they did an awesome job, but I just gotta say thanks to all the guys that run in the Vance Nines stable. They've done an outstanding job all year long.
Is that about the most anxious time you've had in three championship scenarios?
The worst time I've ever had standing on the starting line. I hate not wearing my leathers up here, and to actually not wear my leathers when the championship's on the line is horrible, but my team did such a great job. I'm just sorry I let it down for them today, but at least we got out of here with it.
And guess what? You become a three-time champion along with this man, your brother. What does it mean to you?
You know, it seemed like the third time was the hardest for me, too, and I'm just glad this is over with. This is an awesome year, and Andrew's been doing a great job all year. You know, you can't count out a little red light. Throw a bucket of ice on this thing. It's over.
Good news, bad news. Good news, you're the champs. The bad news, the check and the trophy are way down there. Go get it.
We step in with Antron Brown, battled it right down to the very wire. The emotion at this point, Antron, and I know that the disappointment may be very difficult to put into words, but give it your best shot.
It's just you work so hard all year long, and my team's worked so hard. Steve Tartaglia worked his tail off, and all the boys, Micah, Tom, and all of them, and Calvin, they worked their tails off in that shop day in and day out, and we fell short this year, but we had a great year. I mean, we went strong this whole year, Angel and myself. We finished second and third this year, and hats off to the Vance and Hines team, but it just gives me a lot of motivation on the offseason because next year I'm going to come back twice as strong and And trust me, it's not going to be too many red lights next year, especially when NHRA changes that tree. And we're going to push the envelope. And God help me, it's not. I ain't going to be friendly with too many people next year.
Thank you, Gary. As you see the celebration going down to the far end of the racetrack, because as Dave pointed out, that's where they had everything set up. So for Andrew Hines, he picks up his third championship in a row to join Matt, his brother, and Angel Sampei as the only three title winners in a row. Just coasted on through to take the win.
Hoist that, Wally. What does this feel like, the first one of this season?
Oh, my God, this is the greatest thing ever.
To get a third championship for my Screaming Eagle V-Rod would mean an awful lot to me. My brother won three championships in a row, and that's just something I've wanted to do ever since I have been around racing.
And as we take a look to set up the semifinals, it will be Matt Gadara with Lane Choice over Tom Bradford in one of our semifinals. And then the lane choice in the second one will go to Craig Treble by 5/100ths over Matt Smith. We get ready to head to commercial break. That's Andrew's reaction when he saw the wind light go on in Craig Treble's lane. Stay with us. We still have one more championship to be decided. HD presented by Olivia. Picture perfect day in Southern California. You see the San Gabriel Mountains off into the distance here at Auto Club Raceway, and what a huge crowd. The brand new suites sitting on top there. They were just installed for this weekend's event, and we are getting ready for semifinal action. In case you missed it, in Top Fuel, round number two, the championship. Tony Schumacher in the right lane. Rod Fuller gets all kinds of problems with his engine, and Shu makes easy work of it to advance to one semifinal. Then Doug Coletta in the right lane. Tire smoking J.R. Todd. Doug makes easy work of it, so the championship is still at stake for both Coletta and Schumacher. In funny car, though, it is all over. After Ron Capps had the lane choice in the right lane, he gets all crossed up at mid-track. John Force goes on to take the win and his 14th funny car championship, to the delight of the thousands that are here in attendance. All right, let's take a look at our ladder, and you can see on opposite sides, it's Melanie Troxell who can help out her teammate, Tony Schumacher. She's got the lane choice.
If she doesn't, that means Doug Coletta wins the championship, so that's a key matchup there.
So the engines have fired here in the first semifinal. It'll be Doug Coletta. He does not have lane choice, and this could be significant because when those guys back away, notice the sun goes right into his eyes. It'll be behind him right there in the tree in the foreground. Could be very difficult for him to see. Gives you an idea. There's the sun angle. Melanie Troxell will be over in the right lane. Take a look at the wins by lane, Mike.
Yeah, the right lane, big advantage there, 11-1. And the key here, Doug Coletta didn't get lane choice because the car was soft and it shook in the previous round. He had to backpedal to save the run, but he lost lane choice. Now, the left-hand lane has always been critical. He'll be able to see going down the racetrack just fine. The problem is looking at the Christmas tree to be able to see that amber light come on as soon as you need to.
And earlier today, there was some concern in that left lane, too, for some rubber peeling up. I remember talking about that at the beginning of the show, but from Jim Oberhoffer to John Oberhoffer to Ron Tobler, every crew chief on the Coletta team has gone out there, and their consensus is that perhaps that has filled in a little bit better, and it's their belief that that left lane is actually a little bit better once you get out there about 100-150 feet. Because of that, they feel like they've got a pretty good opportunity here to get an A to B run and pick up a championship.
Yeah, I definitely agree. There's a, you know, the left lane's good. We saw John Force run a 4.74 in that lane. Robert. Like Dave said, it is a starting line. They did scrape it. They needed to get that rubber to fill back in because left lane was pretty much the lane that people liked during qualifying. It just kind of changed on race day when they had to do that big scrape before the first round.
Also remember, Melanie beat Doug the last time these two met. It was the semifinals at Reading. She ran a 4.51 to his 4.56. There's Tony Schumacher waiting to come up to the line next. Coletta wins. Championship is his. Melanie Troxell in a whole
shot. 4.502 to a 450 flat. The door is now open for Tony Schumacher. He must win the race and set the national record in elapsed time. It is the second whole shot loss this season for Doug Coletta. Could not have come at a worse moment.
But you know, Doug Coletta did his job on the starting line. Let's face it, he was 0.58 reaction time. Melanie rolled her in a little bit, but, she hit that 0.26, 300 of a second advantage off the starting line. Take a look at Doug. I think, there wasn't a whole lot wrong. He went up there and did everything on paper. I think if they looked at it, they would go out there and do exactly the same thing. They just came out short because Melanie just basically, nailed the tree, whether she took a shot at her, was in a little bit deep. End result, doesn't matter. She is in the final.
Her first whole shot win of the season. And you're right. I mean, the numbers show out that normally that would be a great light for Doug, but the definition of whole shot is what it is. And now here is the scenario. Tony has to win the race and set the national elapsed time record. And right now, track temperature is at 89 degrees. What do you think?
No, right now he's just going to go for the win over Brandon Bernstein. If he can get that win, which is not going to be easy because Brandon's been running awfully well, they will go for the national record in the final round for sure.
Well, Doug Coletta is here, and now the waiting game for you begins. How are your nerves?
Yeah, it'll be interesting. Unfortunately, we got beat there, and we'll just have to wait it out and see what happens.
Is that a shock to you?
No, I mean, we just got up there and did the best we could, and obviously it's a little disappointing we didn't get the win, but we'll just have to wait and see.
All right, thanks.
Ron Tobler, you've now seen the numbers. It is a waiting game. Your impressions of the run?
Well, I was happy with the run. I mean, that's about what we were shooting for. I think we made a nice recovery from the round before. She stepped up, had a great light. Doug was ahead of his average, so we'll just have to wait and see what happens.
Does this championship go one more round, or does it end here in about 4.5 seconds? We'll find out shortly.
What's interesting about Tony Schumacher and Brandon Bernstein, they have only raced each other in final round competition this season. Tony beat him at St. Louis for his first win of the season. Brandon won at Brainerd, and then Tony won at Indy. This is the first time they've met this year where it hasn't been a final.
And it's a great matchup. Both these cars have been running very well all weekend long. Alan Johnson's got a handle on that Army car, but Tim Richards has really had a good handle on that Budweiser car. Also, when we see the lanes are pretty even, we saw a pair of 450s go off right ahead of them.
Schumacher and the championship goes on. 4.48 seconds, 329 miles an hour. And Tony Schumacher must now go to the final, win the race, and set a national elapsed time record to deny Doug Coletta his first championship and for Tony to claim his fourth.
Well, Alan Johnson, stage is now set. Can we do it?
Drama is all about drama, isn't it? Well, I think we can. You know, the conditions are going to be pretty similar to last night, and you saw the numbers they put up last night. So,
is that song going to be able to get down far enough, do you think?
Oh, well, yeah, I think so. You know, we're looking at that track is really good right now, and we're going to be excited about giving it a shot.
I'm saying, does it really matter even if it doesn't go down? They still need that national record.
Mike, let's talk about it. What do you think? How much will the conditions change?
Well, this time of year when the sun goes down, it goes down very quickly. And we can see, the track will cool off considerably and get much tighter. We saw that last evening. One of the key things there, what really important was for Tony Schumacher, he got lane choice in the final round. I think that's very important also to go for that national record.
Gary?
And with Tony Schumacher, this is the moment you've been talking about. You said get to the finals, set the national record. The stage is now set. How about the conditions? Do you think it's going to be dark enough and cool enough that you can really take a run at that national record?
Well, I hope so. It would be so unfortunate to come this far and be the fans sitting in the stands getting to watch this moment and to have the conditions not right. If we don't make it, let's not let it be because the conditions aren't there. This race team has done too good coming back from too far to be in this position. What an awesome job for our teammate Melanie. That was cool, man. That was what we call a teammate right there. That's the big help we needed. But for the U.S. Army, for Trigicon, Gates Belt and Hoses, Madco Tools, all the people that stuck with us, Valvoline, we love you guys, and this is the moment we've all been waiting for.
Just remember how far he's come. He was over 330 points out of it after 10 races this year.
And this is a rematch of last year's finals right here. It was Tony beating Melanie in that race last season. Stay with us. We're coming back. Automobile Club of Southern California Finals. We are getting ready for semifinal action in Funny Car. John Force has clinched the championship. Jack Beckman's in the right lane, looking to go to back-to-back finals in his young career. Phil Burkhart looking to go for his second final this year. That was Jenna, the new wife of Jack Beckman. She's cheering her husband on. There she is again. Good fortunes continue. His new bride loves it, and Jack has a 474 in the bank. He already backed up his national speed record earlier today. He's had a great couple of weeks. What do you think?
Can't get much better than that. Second straight final, gets married. Boy, he's loving life right now. Take another look at it. Remember the run before left lane, Jack Beckman drove it out of the groove and got loose. This time it moved over a little towards the center line, but no big deal. He was able to keep it down the middle, and team owner Don Schumacher likes what he sees because Jack's in the final once again.
And there's Jack at the far end of the racetrack. So while Jack Beckman's celebrating at the far end, there's Tony Schumacher getting the cheers from the crowd as he heads back to the pits to get ready for the Top Fuel final. Meanwhile, at the starting line, it's time for John Force and his son-in-law and teammate Robert Height to square off. Of course, the pressure's off for everybody. John's already clinched his 14th. Title, and Robert says, that's okay, my day's coming.
Yeah, I'm sure it is. I mean, Robert Height's a tremendous talent. Jimmy Prock, obviously, he's proven himself a number of times, making a ton of horsepower. Good matchup here. John's taking the left-hand lane. Obviously, you know, they like something over in that left-hand lane. They didn't get it by choice the previous round, but evidently they like what they saw after that 474 in the second round.
Some other numbers for you to consider. John has qualified now for 392 straight races. It would take you 17 years at his start right now to catch up to him. And if he wins here, 195th career final. And he's got it because Robert hits the blocks. An automatic DQ, and John goes 4.83 seconds at 265. So he is now into his 195th career final and 11th here at the finals at Pomona. So if we take one more look at the run, we head to break, and it'll be time for the factory hot rods when we return here to Pomona. Auto Club Raceway at Pomona, you're looking at one of the unsung institutions. That's Lefty Grice. He's been in drag racing for 50 years, 30 of them, the last 31 with NHRA. He works on the safety safari. He's retiring at the end of the day, and that was earlier when he congratulated John Force on winning his 14th championship. Farewell, Lefty. All right, let's get caught up on Pro Stock. We want to focus on the championship. But Jason Lyne, again and again and again, he wins very easily, going to his ninth final of the 06 campaign, third in a row. And then Greg Anderson, well, he takes care of business. He's going to his 64th team final, beating Alan Johnson. It's the 10th time in team history that teammates will square off in a final. Then in Pro Stock Motorcycle, it was Craig Treble all over Matt Smith. Treble going to his 20th career final. And believe it or not, this guy was nowhere near the top 10 when the day started. If he wins the final, he'll be in 10th position and on the stage. And then it was Tom Bradford dumping Matt Cadera in a hole shot. Bradford's going to his first ever final with a 7:11 elapsed time to the quicker, but losing 7:07. And his work continues back at Tony Schumacher's pit. Take a look at this. After 10 races this year, he was behind 336 points. He's 26 behind as we head to the final round. And he's got to set the national record to claim the championship.
Today's Speed World presentation of the Automobile Club of Southern California NHRA Nationals. Brought to you by Powerade. Sport is what you make it. Auto Club, we're always with you. And Wendy's. Get in the middle of flavor. Do Wendy's new double melt and do what tastes right.
And of course, that is the fact that we have seen two champions crowned. We still have one more to go as we get ready for our pro finals here at Auto Club Raceway. Track temperature 89 degrees. The sun is setting over the track right now, cooling it down. Will it be enough for a national ET record in Top Fuel? We'll find out in a matter of moments. Right now, it's time for Tom Bradford in the left lane, Craig Treble in the right lane. Craig in his ninth career, looking for his ninth career win. Here we go. And Craig Treble does it. 7.07 seconds, denying Tom Bradford his first ever Wally. Craig picks up his ninth. It's his first win in over 2 years. The last time he claimed a Wally, Brainerd in 2004.
It's hard to believe it's been that long, Marty, but this is a well-deserved win. He had a very good motorcycle all week. And take another look at left side of your screen. He's been good on the lights all day, consistent. And that Suzuki has been running consistently all weekend.
Thanks for reminding me.
Well, Craig Treble, it's been over 2 years since you've had this opportunity, and it puts you in the top 10. You'll be on the podium tomorrow night for the big awards presentation.
I didn't.
How good is it feeling?
First of all, that just surprises me because I did not know we went into the top 10. I'm excited, but you know what? We didn't bring any clothes, no tuxedos. We're planning on going on home. So I guess I got to buy my wife a new dress. That's it. Matt, Gary, I got to thank so many people. And first and foremost, Gary, Harry, and Joanne Lartigue, man, they've kept this team together. They've kept it together financially. We've had zero sponsorship for the past year and a half. And Harry is such a dedicated, diehard racer, man. He's got a big, giant needle stuck in his arm. I think he's a junkie. But this NHRA Power 8 drag racing is the most awesome thing. I just can't begin to. I gotta thank Matco Tools. I gotta thank American Fire, Speed Graphics, Skinner Interior Systems, Pro Vans, all the people that stuck with us. Thanks, guys.
All right.
All right, let's get ready now for Jason Line and Greg Anderson. Dave Reif.
Bittersweet moment for Ken Black. He's guaranteed the Wally, but he's going to lose a crewman. That's Jeff Purley, who is moving on to own a Goodyear store in Charlotte. They will say goodbye to him after this final.
To finish the season in pro stock. They both cut 005 lights. There's Jeff Purley saying farewell. Good luck, Jeff. You did fine. 6.65 seconds for the winning Greg Anderson, his 43rd pro stock race.
Boy, 005 for both of them, but you saw the right-hand lane. Jason Line looked like he just spun the tire way too hard, and that allowed Greg Anderson to get the win.
How much fun, Greg Anderson, has this weekend been with no pressure, the point championships and everything having been determined at Las Vegas?
It's absolutely been a blast, Gary. You know, you don't get many chances like this. I can't say enough about this Summit Race and Pontiac team. I'm a lucky man to be part of it. Jason Line's a lucky man to be part of it. You know, we've got so many great things happening for us. I want to say a special thanks to my co-crew chief, Jeff Purley. He's moving on to bigger, better things. He's going to start his own business. We're all behind him on it. We thank him so many times for the four championships in a row for this team. Couldn't have done it without him. Thank you, everybody. Mac Tools, Fairway Chevrolet, Red Line Oil, PSI Valve Springs, Wilson Venable. Thank you so much.
Start of the season with a win right here. He ends the season with another victory.
And as we get ready for our funny car final, John Force will be over in the left lane. Jack Beckman over in the right lane. Been a big time in Jack's life. Of course, if you were with us earlier, you know about it from our Power 8 Power Time feature. A cancer survivor. He just got married this past week. His wife, Jenna, she's at the starting line. Here we go. The wind light goes to Forrest, but look at Jack Beckman. 4.662 is a new national laps time record. He also has the speed record, but Force gets his 122nd race win. The 14-time champ does it again. But wow, what a run by Jack Beckman as well.
Take now a look at this. Actually, John Force gets a whole shot advantage off the starting line by just over 300ths of a second, and he needed it. That 469 beats that 466 of Jack Beckman.
Well, John Force, the quickest side-by-side funny car race in history. You get the Wally, you get the win. What has this day been like? Because you win a championship and you win the event.
This day's been a roller coaster. It's been up and down of emotions for me. But we finished 1, 2, and 4. That's what Castrol, that's what Ford, that's what AAA of Auto Club Southern Cal pays us to do. That's the bottom line. And you know what's really cool? To run neck and neck with Beckman. But I know,
right here, bro.
Beck, did you get that record? I don't. But I said to Coyle, you want to go for the record? He said, this heap will run it. Or do you want to go for the win? He said, maybe we ought to let Beckman have and save the point. So I stole all the tree I could get on
you. Winner shower.
And we got to go. We got another championship to be determined right now.
All right. Thanks, Gary. There it is. Tony Schumacher, to win the championship, he not only has to win the race, he has to set a new national ET record. There's the range that he can run in and make that mark stick. He's already got the backup for those numbers. A very anxious Doug Coletta, wondering if he will get his first ever Top Fuel Championship.
Boy, it's nervous time for Doug Coletta because Jack Beckman set the national record in that right-hand lane, and he was all over the track. That was probably a little bit quicker, so it looks like the conditions are definitely there to be able to set a national record, and we know that this car is capable of doing it, but we, like we heard last night when Allen was going for it before they had the oil leak, he says, you know, everything, he's dial in the number, but everything has to work perfect.
And remember, it's a two-part equation. Tony Schumacher must also win this race. You got to believe that Melanie Troxell may not make it down here. I know Richard Hogan said they're going to try to run a 40, but that a lot of times means they're going to try a little too hard, if you know what I mean. Two pieces of this puzzle. We're about to find out.
4.436. That's the number he has to have. At least that. Here we go. Look at the numbers! Schumacher, 4.42 seconds. Look at the heartbreak.
Is it to watch that and see that happen?
Yeah, that's a heartbreaker. They got the job done today, and hats off to them. So we'll just have to keep trying.
I just can't imagine what you must be feeling, but congratulations on a great season.
All right, thank you.
Goes down to the final round as he is just devastated. And how could you not be? You go in knowing what you have to have happen, and how many times, I mean, you have just seen the ties for the second quickest run ever in the history of Top Fuel, and they do it when they need it most.
That is just unbelievable. What can you say about that team? I mean, they were, take another look at it. I mean, you saw Tony going really shallow, but at the eighth mile, they run 283 miles per hour, 3 seconds flat. I mean, that's the kind of numbers you need early. They didn't run the big speed on the other end. They made all that elapsed time early, and what a great job by that Army team.
And look at that celebration. Allen Johnson sure did earn his money this season. David?
The moment, it's indescribable.
You're right, it is. It's unbelievable. You know, I mean, you got to hand it to these guys that work on this team. You know, they never gave up. I mean, we never gave up. We just kept battling and battling. There was plenty of times we let it slip away when we thought it was going to be too late. And, you know, they just battled all the way.
Your 10th championship, especially when you figure in all the championships in the alcohol division with your brother. Place you guys debuted after the first time in Winter Circle 95.
Yeah, the same lane, same time of the day, same results. It's awesome. I don't know what to say. It's just awesome. It's awesome.
Well, Tony Schumacher with his son, his wife, Kara, here, the trophy in hand. I'm just overwhelmed at what you have been able to accomplish. And you've said all along you would get to this moment, you would have the shot at the record. How much did you believe? How much anxiety was there for you and your team?
You know, I probably felt better today than I have in weeks racing. It was one of those things. We're far enough back where the pressure was really off. All we had was to go for it, man, and it makes it great to be able to do that. When you got Allen Johnson, the U.S. Army team behind you, you know, there's soldiers everywhere. It was really cool. Right before I ran, a friend of mine came up to me, Roy, and he said, you know, there's a Black Hawk flying around Iraq right now. We just got word, and they're pulling for you, man. So they're probably catching wind of it right now. And one's for you boys, man. We love it. You guys are awesome. What a comeback. Never been done before, but... You know, it's being around guys from the Army and girls, soldiers that give me that never give up attitude. It's about the people you surround yourself with, but there's more people that have helped out. Obviously, we have switched over this year to Valvoline and Gates Belts and Hoses and Matco Tools. We love all you guys. Ranch Ridgecon with the U.S. Army, these soldiers right here, man, to be able to give that back, something that, you know, every day we see in the news people losing lives and getting injured, but to be able to give back to them something like this, and it's not much, but it's all we got, and it's everything we got, and everything was on the table on that one run. That's from that Eminem song, man. When we got one shot, there it was, man, and it paid off.
You've had great moments in your career, obviously, in winning other championships. Does this now surpass all of those moments?
No questions asked. You know, and we've won it in different ways. I won it the first year in 99 by winning one race and just being consistent. I won it in 2000. Oh, I got my bunny ears here. I won it in 2004 by winning 10 races and being a dominant car. And then same with last year, but this, above all, there's just never been anything like it. And I tell everybody, you know, it's not just about winning races every time. It's about adversity. It's about being a team and getting through bad times. Man, we didn't point fingers. We didn't fire people. We stuck together. We brought it to one moment. And even Friday night, when that thing was oiled down and we didn't get the chance, that made it to this moment. I'm going to say that we're going to give that the gratitude to the Lord for that one, because you couldn't have wrote a better script. That one comes from above. To be able to run and to have the conditions, you know.
There's somebody here who wants to offer congratulations.
Unbelievable.
Don, your thoughts about this amazing turnaround from 336 points back to this moment and this trophy?
There was never a doubt in this team, as far as I was concerned, and Alan Johnson, Tony, and all of the guys, they pulled it out, they did the job, and there was never a doubt the middle of this year that they could get it done.
Thank you all, and congratulations.
Thank you.
Joe Amato won three championships in a row. Now Tony Schumacher joins him. He has his fourth Top Fuel title. Only Joe Amato has more, with five. Hail to the victor. Here at Auto Club Raceway, we're still trying to catch our breath after that unbelievable performance by that man right there, Tony Schumacher. Before we get out of here, a reminder, next Sunday, 11:30 a.m. Eastern Time, our final NHRA Today of the 06 campaign. And coming up next, it's NASCAR drivers nonstop right here on ESPN2. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. For Mike Dunn, Dave Reif, Gary Gerald, and our entire ESPN2 crew, I'm Marty Reif. Thanks for going along on the ride in this, the most incredible season in NHRA racing.